Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda is consideration of whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Item 5 is the consideration of the evidence we will hear today on the UK Automated Vehicles Bill. Item 6 is consider the evidence we will hear today on Scotland's railways, and item 7 is to consider correspondence relating to the appointments to the Scottish Land Commission. Do we agree to take these items in private? Yes. We are agreed, thank you. Our next item of business is agenda item 2, is an evidence session with the Scottish Government on the UK Automotive Vehicles Bill. The bill implements the recommendations of a joint report by both the GB Law Commissions on the regulation of automated vehicles. On the 20th of December, the Scottish Government lodged an LCM, a legislative consent memorandum, that reserved its position on whether the Scottish Parliament consent should be given. On the 29th of February, a supplementary memorandum was lodged, which recommended consent to all of the provisions outlined in the LCM other than Clause 50. I note for the record that there seems to be a difference of view between the Scottish and UK governments about whether certain clauses require legislative consent, and that Clause 50 is one of these. The committee has been designated lead committee for the scrutiny of the LCM. In the limited time available to report, we are having this one evidence session with the Scottish Government. We have also had written evidence from the Confederation of Passenger Transport. I'm pleased to welcome Fiona Hislop, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, and she is joined today by Liana Vatlowski, a Scottish Government lawyer, Jim Wilson, the licensing team leader for the Scottish Government, Oi Hang Chu, for the UK Bill and Legislative Consent Manager for Transport Scotland, George Henry, and the Operational Manager for Road Safety Policy and Education for Transport Scotland. Thank you all for joining us today. Cabinet Secretary, I'm going to give you the opportunity for a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for inviting me to discuss the LCM and supplementary LCM for the UK Government's Automated Vehicles Bill. This bill implements the recommendations of a four-year review of the regulation of automated vehicles carried out jointly by the Law Commission of England and Wales and the Scottish Law Commission. The bill prescribes a new framework for the safe deployment of self-driving vehicles in Great Britain. Autonomous vehicles represent a vital part of mobility of the future, and the focus on public safety is required to support this. I welcome the necessary legislative framework, albeit there is concern over some clauses. The late engagement by the UK Government on this bill has also been challenging, given the complexity, the novelty and technical nature of the bill. The Scottish Government considers a number of provisions engaged the LCM process. Clause 40 will require Scottish ministers to provide the Secretary of State with reports from police and local authorities. This is in line with our current policy on sharing safety information with partner agencies to allow us all to learn from incidents. Therefore, we recommend consent. Clauses 46 to 51 establishes the legal liability of the user in charge. Now, a person in a position to exercise control of a vehicle which is being operated by an authorised automated function. The Scottish Government is in disagreement with the UK Government as we consider these clauses to be devolved. Our view is that determining the liability of a user in charge or any other person for devolved offences involving the use of a vehicle would be within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. However, we agree with the policy position of the user in charge provisions and recommend consent to clauses 46 to 49. And 51 only. Clause 50 provides the Secretary of State with the power to change or clarify existing legislation, including acts of the Scottish Parliament, without a mechanism to consent or consult with the Scottish ministers or Scottish Parliament. So we do not recommend consent on Clause 50. Clauses 82 to 90, excluding Clause 86, provides the new powers for Scottish ministers in relation to a system of interim passenger permits over the use of automated vehicles within a private hire and taxi regulatory regime. Now, these clauses are an appropriate approach to reflect the devolved nature of private hire and taxi licensing, and therefore we are recommending legislative consent. So I wish to conclude by saying that the extensive engagement has been taken forward by officials with the UK Government's Department of Transport, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Services and Police Scotland. This ensured we were provided with the expert advice to follow, to allow us to consider and take an informed view on the policy intent of the bill.
Thanks very much, Minister. And I know committee members have some questions. And the first question is going to come from Mark Ruskell. Oh.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and morning to the panel, and thanks for that explanation. Can I just ask you a little bit more than Cabinet Secretary about Clause 50? Now, my understanding is that there might be certain traffic regulations which the UK Secretary of State for Transport could choose to amend. Could you go into a bit more detail about what the scope of that power might be and what your concerns would be specifically around the nature of those regulations and the changes that may or may not happen in Scotland as a result?
Right, so if you can bear with me, and I might bring in colleagues in this because it is fairly complex. Clause 50 contains a broad power for the Secretary of State to change or clarify the application of existing relevant legislation, including acts of the Scottish Parliament, to a user in charge, and that legislation is relevant if it relates to the driving or use of a vehicle. The UK government maintains that these provisions are reserved because they relate to the subject matter of the Road Traffic Act 1988, which is reserved under the Scotland Act 1988, so far as it is concerned with the use of vehicles on roads. And the UK government acknowledges that these provisions will apply to devolved dynamic driving offences, but considers that impacts on devolved matters are incidental to this reserve matter. In the most recent letter, and there's been correspondence, as you can appreciate, back and forward with ourselves and the UK government, in the most recent letter, dated the 13th of March 2024 from the UK government, this has been summarised as the reserve policy of the use of automated vehicles on roads. Now, the Scottish government considers that this takes too broad a view of the reservation. Any and all regulation of the use of conventional vehicles is not reserved. For example, traffic regulation under the Road Traffic Regulation Act 1984 is not reserved. Therefore, any and all regulation of the use of automated vehicles is not a reserved matter. And our view is that the provisions in the Road Traffic Act 1988, quoted by the UK government, in relation to the construction and use of vehicles, are connected with the regulation of minimum standards for the safe use of vehicles. And that is why Part 1, for example, deals with the regulatory regime there. In terms, therefore, of, and if I can conclude on this point, the provisions of this user in charge immunity, which is the 46 to 51 clauses, do not appear to relate to the regulation of minimum standards for the safe use of vehicles. Instead, the Scottish Government's view is that the primary purpose of these provisions is to clarify liability for traffic offences, and in the case of Clause 50, that's civil penalty contraventions of persons in an equivalent position to the driver of a conventional vehicle. So accordingly, modifying offences, which is Clause 50 gives the powers to the UK Government, reserved or devolved, to remove or clarify liability, cannot be incidental. It appears to be the primary reason that these provisions are being made. And to give you some examples of what would be in the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament, issues in relation to civil penalties, but also bus lane issues, things that are to do with offences under devolved legislation and offences that would be part of devolved areas, these are the areas that the provision would allow the UK government to legislate on or to make provision for in the future in the relation to the user in charge immunity. So I know that's quite complex, and I apologise to colleagues if I've not quite got that right. They can correct me. But that's the explanation of what the difference of opinion is. So we think it's a genuine issue of concern. And I know that the committee stage of the UK government on this bill is taking place today, and that's one of the issues that's being debated there as well.
Okay. Okay. I'm just wondering if there's any more kind of detail of examples that you can give. I mean, is there a potential here for divergence in the way that liability is treated across the UK, or?
Well, I think it's going to be important.
There's a principle point here, which is that the Scottish Parliament needs to be able to decide on this. But I'm just wondering what, if there are any practical issues that may arise in relation to that.
So I'll bring in colleagues to bring in if there's any examples of practical issues they want to bring in. But this is obviously a framework bill. But there's a desire to have consistency approach across the UK for what is a really new policy area in terms of automated vehicles, and we agree with that, and that mm-hmm. makes sense. But when it applies to devolved areas, that's where we think that needs to be, at the very least, as this committee and others will know, consultation with Scottish ministers about issues that may impact. And of course, the user in charge immunity is a brand new concept, but the issues about what can happen to the vehicle in devolved areas is similar to what might happen to a vehicle if it had been driven by some, like a human being. So therefore, it's the consequences of that, and therefore the penalties or the civil offences that are at issue. But I'm going to ask colleagues, George, sorry.
But help me, because it seems quite abstract, this. I'm still trying to get around the fact that I'm going to get into a car and there's going to be no driver, and I'm going to put my life in the hands of a computer, which I have some fears about. People may say that about my driving anyway, but what I'm trying to work out is where an offence, an example of an offence would be, that you think is things. So, you know, if one of your officials could give a real-life example that I can understand, it would probably make it less abstract
so
for me.
At that very moment, I was about to bring in George Henry, who would hopefully help illustrate what this could mean in practice, if it helps, it brings to life. And I know conceptually this could be quite a challenging area, but we do need to move with the times, convener. And I think that, you know, they are already on automated vehicles abroad, if you know what I mean. So therefore, in terms of the framework legislation, we need this, but we need to do it in a sensible way and anticipate what the implications would be. George.
Okay, thanks. So this will include various devolved legislation in the sort of criminal sphere in relation to dynamic driving offences, such as contraventions to traffic orders under the Road Traffic Regulation Act 1984, so speed limits could be one of them, as well as other examples could be low emission zones, as well as parking and bus lane contraventions. So if the user in charge in the vehicle is travelling along a road and the speed limit is different, they could end up having a speeding offence that is attached to them when they've not been in charge of the vehicle. And again, this is devolved powers that are obviously set within the Scottish Parliament.
Just help me. So user in charge is Muggins driving the vehicle. That's me driving the vehicle. And if I park in a bus lane or I enter an LEZ, then I'll be subject to an offence. But if it's an automated vehicle, then I'm not in charge of the vehicle. So the responsibility lies with somebody else. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, it lies with
the manufacturer. What I don't understand is why there's any difference, you know, why there's a difficulty here.
Well, we agree with you, because we think that conceptually it's the same thing, whether it's you as an individual or the automated vehicle. But the UK government's saying differentiating the difference and saying because the automated driver is an automated driver, it doesn't apply in the same way. So you're right. That's why we agree.
Oh, no,
with you.
No. Yeah. I understand that, you know, if you've got one vehicle designed to use across only the United Kingdom, say, and there's some fault in the software, and it commits an offence, then it can't be the person who's nominally in charge of the vehicle but not driving it at the time.
So, yes, that's correct, because the effect, the problem would be with the vehicle and the manufacturer of the vehicle. The issue about Clause 50 is about changes to devolved legislation, the speeding, or give them powers over the speeding or the other aspects that would be offences.
But the 1988 Road Traffic Act, which you did it anticipate automated vehicles?
That's the problem, I suspect not. And so therefore this is a retrospect. How do you fit in what is novel legislation in a situation that you're almost you're bolting it on to existing traffic provisions? Now, the existing traffic provisions, quite clearly many of them are devolved. All we're trying to do is respect those devolved issues there, and I think you bring up an important point which I haven't referenced, which is the need to review the legislation, precisely because it is new legislation. It's an issue we've raised with the UK government. They say clause 38 is sufficient because it reviews the practice and the experience of automated vehicles, whereas we think, and you know, because this is going to be involved, remember this is a framework bill, so the secondary regulations are going to be important areas as well. The UK government have said that they will engage with Police Scotland and also the Crown Office, but it's new territory, so we think actually a kind of more established formal review of the actual legislation will be needed, precisely because you've got a new piece of legislation that's working with old pieces of legislation in a brand new area, which is novel to all of us.
We could get into the inadequacies of framework legislation, if you like, but I trod on your toes, George, when you were speaking. Do you want to complete what you were saying?
Yeah, so just essentially, is just to try and provide an explanation or an example, is that there will be devolved legislation that has been brought in either by roads authorities or even through the Scottish Parliament, that the Clause 50 allows the Secretary of State to the potential to change that. Hence the reason why we're not supportive of that area, because there could be decisions made by this Parliament for the right reasons of why we've implemented something such as a low emission zone in an area, and then that could potentially be changed through this Clause 50.
Thanks, George. Mark, it was your question.
It was my question indeed, yes. But you've done well to kind of dine out on it. But I think that's clear from my point of view. I mean, it is a complex area and it's a new and emerging technology. But I think it would be odd to have two sets of rules, effectively. A set of rules for automated vehicles and a set of liabilities and regulations relating to that, but then a completely different set of rules for everybody else. So it feels like there's the potential for mismatch there. I hope that would never happen. But I think Clause 50, raises the spectre that might happen, and that would be, I think, very problematic. So if that summarises your concerns with some real examples that you've just given us, then I can understand where it's coming from. And I think clarity is what's needed right now, rather than a confusing introduction of a technology that apparently has a different set of rules to everything else.
And it's potential for change in the future. So therefore, if we are going to have some consistency across the UK, even the basics of talk to us about it or consult with us formally in terms of if there was any changes in the future, that's all that's been asked for by the Scottish Government, which we don't think is unreasonable, bearing in mind the rest of the bill we're giving consent to. There's still issues the UK Government probably wouldn't want to consider, 46 to 51, all of them. As LCM issues, we do, but as it happens, we agree with the policy content, so we're not objecting to the rest of them apart from 50, for the reasons you set out.
Okay.
Now, there are lots of questions. I've got Monica, followed by Ben, followed by Bob.
Oh, thank you, Convener. I think my questions will be quite boring now in comparison to what we've just heard. So we know the bill will create a new system for the regulation of bus and taxi services provided by automated vehicles. So, Cabinet Secretary, can you tell us a little bit more about the Scottish Government's consultation with bus and taxi industry representatives on these proposals, and what were the key issues that emerged, and how have any concerns been addressed?
So in terms of the consultation, remember this came out of it took over a number of years, and it was the Scottish Law Commission that conducted the work and also the consultation, and there's probably a list somewhere of the people that they consulted with. So this was not remember, it's a UK government bill that's come out of, quite often, obviously legislation can come out of Law Commission reports. So it's their recommendations, and that's what's come out of this in terms of what the legislation is. There are provisions, and if I can bring in Jim as to I suppose the issues and I suspect the need for ongoing ongoing issues around licensing in relation to the taxi and bus industry in relation to this. Jim, can I bring you in that?
Yeah, of course. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks to Ms Lennon for the question. We've had pretty strong engagement with a range of stakeholders in relation to taxi and private hire car policy more generally. So there is that kind of pool of key stakeholders that we can certainly tap into in relation to regulations that will come further down the line. Some of the concerns that, from a policy-making perspective, that I wanted to highlight to committee generally revolve around the need to think about unintended consequences. So if you think about, and I'll use a retail sector analogy, but you know, self-scanning till points, where I'm sure retail workers might have had some concerns that what's the impact on their jobs, what's the impact on their livelihoods if the intention in the store was simply that the customer can go to the self-scanning point. So suppose if you're thinking about people that have a reliance on taxis and private hire car licensing, and ultimately they have a provision in their communities to travel from point A to B. If suddenly there's a real desire to have a behavioural change so that there is no driver, I think we need to be mindful about the impact on citizens, but also the impact on the taxi sector more generally. I mean, there was a debate in Parliament many, many months ago around the challenges around the provision of taxi drivers or taxi services within Glasgow. So I think that from an employment perspective, we just need to be mindful about the impact. Technology is a wonderful thing, but we need to be mindful about the impact on sectors that would be directly impacted upon that. So just to give a flavour of some of the key stakeholders that we're engaging with. So in the main, it would be because this would disapply the taxi and private hire car licensing provisions. We have strong working relationships with SOLAR, so they provide the legal advice to licensing boards for alcohol and also licensing authorities for civic licensing, including taxis and private hire. But we also have a good engagement with a range of other stakeholders. That includes representatives from Unite the Union, private hire car operators, and some other key taxi stakeholders as well. I think for me, there's two key points, and I'll be brief. First point is really just in relation to accessibility. So I appreciate the devil's in the detail when it comes to the regulation-making powers, but we just want to ensure that there's not any unintended consequences to ensure that any services where there is no driver, that it doesn't actually have an impact on accessibility for those who want to use that service. So it needs to be, I suppose, through that equality lens that we look at the policy development going forward. And just picking up on Mr. Ruskell's point, I think more generally one of the concerns would be is really just around a consistency of approach. So if we have an interim permit regime, it would look odd to an operator who has a UK-wide presence if the system is completely different in England and Wales compared to Scotland. So I think that we need to absolutely do what's right for Scottish policy interests, but closely collaborate and work with the Department for Transport around the makeup of this regime going forward. So we've got the communication channels are well in place in terms of engaging with taxi and private hire car stakeholders. But we need, as I said, we need to go wider than that and ensure that when we're actually trying to develop or design a new system, that we place users at the heart of that development going forward.
Thank you to Jim Wilson. That's really helpful. So encouraged to hear there's been maybe not a formal consultation, but there is wide engagement. And you mentioned a number of key stakeholders there, including some of the unions as well, which is important. So maybe a wider question then, because obviously there's the provisions of this bill, which is not a Scottish Government bill, but more generally there have been concerns raised about the impact of automated vehicles on workers. You gave that good example about the self-scanning checkouts in supermarkets. We've all had our ups and downs with those, I'm sure. I know there was a trial in Scotland with self-driving buses, I believe, in 2023. Concerns were raised about what this could mean for workers in terms of safety, but in terms of, you know, workforce planning for the future. So I just wonder, Cabinet Secretary, if you can maybe speak to that in terms of workforce planning, because we know that there's obviously a shortage of bus drivers, but are there any issues that you're picking up on? And maybe just to pick up on Mr. Wilson's point about the importance of that collaboration and discussion with the Department of Transport. Do you feel satisfied that there's good dialogue with the UK government on these matters?
So there's quite a lot in there, so I'll try and recall a number of them. The CAV Force project, the project CAV Force, ran from May 2019. And the bus service entered operation in May 23 to August 23. That was a project partners had Fusion Processing, Stagecoach, Alexander Dennis, Napier University and Bristol Robotics. And it was also support, I think it was Innovate UK. Transport Scotland's not been subsequently directly involved, but obviously there's a number of trials that are taking place in different parts of the UK. And obviously the exchange and monitoring is really, really important. And in terms of, I suppose, what was the there was another, I'm trying to remember, Jim, do you want to come into points that reflect what you were asked about?
Yeah, just there's certainly two points Ms Lennon's raised around kind of the workforce ramifications, which I think is a hugely important point and needs to be worked through. I think the other point, and again, it'll come as no surprise that when I was thinking about the opportunities that this framework bill can offer, which are significant, but also think we need to be mindful about the safety aspect. So I think citizens would want to have absolute confidence that if they were to take that leap of faith and actually go into a vehicle where there is no driver, that safety has to actually be at the heart of that permitting regime. So be brief, but I mean, I think it's worth drawing committee members to one of the key Law Commission recommendations within their report, which actually call for a new in-use safety assurance scheme to provide regulatory oversight of automated vehicles throughout their lifetime to ensure that they continue to be safe and comply with road rules. So we recognise safety of passengers used in certainly private hire and taxis as paramount, and as the bill progresses, there will certainly be opportunity to have wide-ranging discussions with Department for Transport to consider absolutely to ensure that there is safety that remains at the heart of this process, because I think there is a change in terms of trying to persuade the general public that this is the right way to go, because I think there will be a nervousness amongst certain individuals around going from the safety of their own vehicle, driving that vehicle, to maybe jumping into a vehicle where there is no driver.
Yeah. And I think that issue about user in charge, therefore, becomes quite important, because that's somebody else in the vehicle. Although it's been it's an automated vehicle, but there'll be times where there might be instructions from the computer to say, in transition, you need to take over because of whatever circumstances. Mm-hmm. So in terms of people and deployment and drivers working, there are likely to be a transition where it would go to a user in charge, as opposed to you're just on the vehicle, the vehicle just drives itself and there's no other human there. But I think in terms of socialising the issue around jobs and the implications, I think we've all got a responsibility, I think, to raise, you know, what does this mean? And I know the Parliament had a debate, I think I took part in it as a backbencher in June last year, on AI and what it means generally. But we can't give you all answers, because this is a developing area, but if you don't prepare for it and anticipate it, then the market will take over. And that's the interesting aspects about how you regulate in this sphere, and that's obviously what the UK government's done after quite an extensive period of that Law Commission study report.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Monica. Ben, you've got some questions then, Bob.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to your officials. I just wanted to go back to the proposed Clause 50. I share your concerns and that you've expressed on behalf of the government. You spoke about how there had been some engagement prior to publication of the bill and some correspondence, but I just would be grateful if you could comment further on how meaningful that engagement was from the UK government on Clause 50, both prior to and since publication, and what the timescales were.
So the bill obviously was announced at the King's Speech, and it's moved quite rapidly. I think that's fair to be said, despite the fact that obviously there was anticipation something would be coming because of the Law Commission's collective work, or the various Law Commission's collective work. So therefore, it was a quite tight time period in that. I think it's not just ourselves, there's issue here for the Crown Office and also for Police Scotland, as well as policy officials. So I think in that short period of time, there's been as much engagement at official level as they can do. I hadn't spoken to the Minister in charge, although we've had various pieces of correspondence, some of it in the last week, which if hasn't been copied to the committee, happy to do so. But basically, we've been reinforcing the main points of 46 to 51 is in devolved areas. We'll agree to all of them from a legislative consent point of view. They dispute that. And also the issues around review, the issue around Clause 38 not being sufficient because it just reviews the practice of what actually happens on the roads, as opposed to is this legislation fit for purpose and does it need reviewed. So that's been the tenor of it. It's been as cooperative as we can be, but as I was trying to explain later, that the secondary regulations are going to be as important, I suspect, as obviously the substantive framework aspects of the UK bill. So there's going to be the need for that. And it's moving fairly rapidly, I think, through this. I mean, it's the committee stage in the House of Commons this morning. So this is a staging post, I would suspect, and what will be a continuous dialogue. But I don't know if anybody else of my colleagues wants to add anything to that.
Before you bring anyone else in, Cabinet Secretary, you generously offered that correspondence to the committee. The committee would like to see that. I think it would be useful for us. Sorry.
Could I also just add that if there's anything further the government wants to relay to the committee following the committee stage in the House of Commons, be interested in any further comment on that. It strikes me that the engagement prior to the bill's publication in terms of considering devolved matters wasn't as meaningful as it could have been. That'd be a fair assessment.
I think it could have been better, but I recognise it's complex. And I think the issue that is at the heart of this is a failure to differentiate between the technology of the automated vehicle and the rules of the road. And the rules of the road effectively are what are devolved, whereas the technology monitoring is obviously, we can appreciate that's in a reserve matter, as is the 88 legislation that talks about the standards of vehicles. But the issue is you've got this bridge now where the vehicle have become the driver, as opposed to the cars that you and I drive, which are obviously regulated by reserve matters. It's when it starts interacting with the rules of the road, which is the issue. So, I don't want to put officials in the position of having to answer where they are in terms of that discussion. It's a challenging area, to be fair.
I'm
disappointed there isn't an understanding in such a challenging, new and novel area that the UK government doesn't appreciate. There has to be good understanding and even preparedness to consult us on Clause 50. That addition would actually recognise that they understood the difference between devolved competence under 1984 traffic offences legislation, which is the rules of the road, and the rules of the road are still devolved. They're not reserved. This opens up the opportunity for them to become reserved, which I don't think is any, I don't even know that that's their intention. It may well be, but that's when you completely get conspiratorial as to the reach of the UK government's powers, but I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Oh. Cabinet Secretary, just very briefly on this. Again, it's in Clause 50, and Mr Henry was very helpful trying to bring this to life because it can be quite abstract until we actually see the detail. But listening to some of the explanations, I was seriously Googling bus lane infringements to see what this could mean in practice. Now, I think, and I could have got this wrong, that the Scottish Government sets the maximum you can fine for breach of a bus lane by statute instrument in this place, £60 maximum, and then there's variations, £30 if you pay early, and 50% additional if you don't. In the UK, it's £130 in London, and I think it's up to £70 elsewhere in the UK. So just hold that thought there a second. If Clause 50 was exercised for automated vehicles and set the fines regime for infringement across the UK, could we end up with a two-tier system in Scotland where drivers of vehicles pay one set of fines and the liable individual for the automated vehicle is paying under a different fines regime? And is that a two-tier system that I think would be undesirable within Scotland?
Yes, and that's exactly what the Clause 50, as it currently stands, could lead to. I'm not saying it will lead to it, but it could lead to it. I would also say that there are requests from some local authorities to increase that the bus lane infringement amounts in Scotland as well, but they are devolved currently. But that's probably a very good example of what the UK government in its current drafting would enable to happen. And that could end up, if you had a judgmental view as to trying to drive the market to automatic vehicles, for example, then you might want to have a differentiated system. But I don't think that makes sense, because going back to the point about the rules of the road, I think it'll be easier for everybody if the rules of the road were consistent between, and there will be a period where there'll be hybrid use, there'll be ourselves, and then there'll be everybody else, and user in charge and vehicles, etc. Do you know, there could be potential for there will be a period of hybrid activity, and I don't think it would make sense for that differentiation between rules of the road, fines, etc. to happen. I'm not saying the UK government would do it, but that's exactly what that Clause 50 would enable and allow.
And just I think that's helpful. And just for clarity, I'm sorry, Mr. Henry, I think you might want to come in just to add to this. So I've given the example of a two-tier system in Scotland between automated vehicles and vehicles that have been driven in the way Mr. Mountain would drive his vehicle, or maybe safer than Mr. Mountain would drive his vehicle, but a two-tier system potentially in relation to bus lane fines, but also in relation to parking infringements, also in relation to speeding, low-emission zones. So there's quite an extensive list where there could be a two-tier system within Scotland for vehicles committing the same infringement?
The answer is yes, but George, do you want to comment on that? Is that a good explanation?
Yeah, I mean, I think just to agree with you, Mr. Doris, that's exactly what the potential is with Clause 50, hence the reason why we don't accept that it's the right thing to do, because I think that, you know, from a rules of the road and law and understanding perspective from Scottish motorists and road users and from a safety perspective, a two-tier approach I don't think is beneficial.
Okay, and I'm sorry for labouring the point. I just had to be clear in my own head. Thank you very much.
Right, we are running short of time. So, Mark, I'm going to give you a short question.
Just further to that, I was just thinking about speed limits, and is there potential for two tiers with automated vehicles and conventional vehicles with speed limits? Because you've got a devolved context now in Wales where there's a national speed limit built up areas of 20 mile an hour. Could potentially automated vehicles be run at a different speed, so a different set of rules of road under Clause 50? Or is it
be allowed if the UK Secretary of State used his powers that are enabled under the current Clause 50 to do that?
Right.
So that would be a policy decision, hypothetical in that situation.
Yeah. Okay, so in theory that grants the powers. And can I just ask finally...
Mark, can I think George would...
Sorry, George.
Just to be clear on that, though, I think that if the Secretary of State was to change the speed limit on a road, that would apply to all vehicles, not just automated vehicles, I think, because it would look like they would be changing everything, you know, the actual speed limit on that road. It wouldn't... and that's where there's a bit of a concern in terms of if a speed limit is being reduced, because we're going through the national strategy for reducing speed limit in built-up areas in Scotland at the moment down to 20 mile per hour. If there was a suggestion of a change in that, then it could impact legislation that we've already approved in Scotland.
Okay. I'm going to let that sink in a bit. Can I just ask a final question then? It's just about the broader policy context here. I mean, can we devil's advocate and say, I see automated vehicles as a bit of a costly distraction, and I'm just wondering where it sits within Scottish Government transport policy just now, because we have got major issues with infrastructure investment for conventional bus, that I know the government's working hard to try and support the bus sector on. Is this really right now a realistic, tangible option for bus operators to be investing in automated bus technology? And isn't the cost of this going to be quite astronomical going forward to redesign streets and systems to accommodate these vehicles? So I'm just interested in where we are right now, where we think this might be going in the future.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm very happy if you briefly answer that. It's not part of the LCM. I think it's a legitimate question for a two-sentence answer, Cabinet Secretary.
These are things that we will all have to consider as we go forward, as AI and automated vehicles become increasingly part of our everyday life. But there's, as I say, a journey to go on this for everybody.
Okay.
Is that sufficiently short for you?
That's completely short enough for me, and I think I'm with Jim. I'm a bit concerned about the whole thing anyway. But just looking around to see if there's any further questions. I've got two questions for you, if I may, Cabinet Secretary. You said the Scottish Law Commission had been involved in this from start to finish. Do they have a view on Section 50, if they've been involved in it?
Leanne, do you do that?
It wouldn't be for the Scottish Law Commission to specifically take that kind of analysis. And if I could just ask the convener, what aspect of Clause 50 in particular are you thinking of there?
Well, I'm seeing it's Clause 50 to me seems to be about potentially bears hiding behind trees which haven't actually exposed themselves and become a threat. So it's hypothetical. So I'm wondering if the Scottish Law Commission, if they've been involved right the way through this process, have a fear, or do they share the Scottish Government's fear? Are they more sanguine about it on the basis that this is developing and what happens today could change tomorrow with the speed of AI?
I'm not aware of the Scottish Law Commission taking a particular view. I understand that their recommendation was for the bill to have a power that would enable the application of existing legislation as it applies to the new concept of a user in charge of an automated vehicle to be clarified, as you say, because once the operation starts to take place, it will become apparent where there are gaps and where certain existing legislation now doesn't make sense with regards to a user in charge. So I think that's the intention in terms of Clause 50. It's just in terms of how that will apply to devolved offences and devolved legislation in the sphere of civil sanctions, insofar as Clause 50 would be used to amend that legislation, Scottish Government's view is that engages the LCM process.
I understand that. Does the any other administration, I mean, what do they think about this in Wales? Are they signing up to it?
I have briefing about where Wales are, but I would rather come back to you. I don't want to misrepresent the Welsh position, so we'll come back to you.
Very dangerous thing to do, I would say, Chair, Cabinet Secretary. I'm trying to find out if other people share the Scottish Government's concerns,
remember,
or whether it's just the Scottish Government.
But remember, there are different responsibilities devolved and reserved in Wales in relation to different aspects. So I'm not an expert on Welsh traffic legislation. So I think I would happy to come back to the committee on that once we've checked. I think we have got some indication of what their general views are, but I do not want to misrepresent the Welsh.
Okay. I think they would say that they've got 20 miles an hour speed limits rolled out across Wales quicker than Scotland, so they must have some powers that could be affected by this.
I'm assuming they have, but I can't give you... You asked me about what their view is about Clause 50, and I don't want to misrepresent them on that.
Cabinet Secretary, we're going to have to write a report. I think by next week things are moving that sufficiently quickly that a quick response on that and the correspondence would be helpful.
Yeah, I mean, the correspondence will get right away to you. We'll check what we know about the Welsh position. If we don't know about the Welsh position, we'll let you know that as well.
OK. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our evidence session. And as I said, we are going to consider and agree a short report to the Parliament next week. So thank you for your time this morning. I'm now briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back. Our next agenda item is an evidence session on Scotland Railways. The committee has held evidence sessions on rail services annually since ScotRail entered public ownership in 2022. Since then, we aim to take stock of the state of the rail service in Scotland over the past year. And I'd like to put on record the committee's thanks to three trade unions who have provided us all with written evidence for this session, ASLEF, Unite and the RMT. For our first panel, we'll hear from two of Scotland's independent watchdogs for rail services. And I'm pleased to welcome Liz McLeod, Head of Regulatory Analysis Office for Rail and Road, and Robert Sampson, Senior Stakeholder Manager for Transport Focus. Thank you for joining us this morning. And we have a series of questions, and I'm going to start it off with a very simple question just to get you into the flow of it. How has ScotRail's performance changed since the committee last considered the issues in May 2023? And are passengers getting a noticeably better service? Who'd like to go on that to start with? Robert, do you want to go on that?
Well, it has improved from a passenger satisfaction point of view over the last 12 months. The last rail customer experience survey was published in January, and out of 5 of 7 key factors, including overall satisfaction, punctuality, frequency of trains on the route, level of crowding, cleanliness, value for money, information during journey. On 5 of those 7 important factors, ScotRail are in the top 20% of train operating companies in Great Britain, and never to their average. None of them are significantly lower than average from a passenger perspective, although passengers by and large only travel on the ScotRail network. When you compare it with other operators, satisfaction levels are quite high in the last 12 months.
Has that changed?
Yes, it's improved in the last. It's improved in the last 12 months. It's improved from about. It was in overall satisfaction 12 months ago. I'll give you those figures. It was about 88%, and it's been improved to an average of 90-91%. So there's a small improvement in overall satisfaction.
And nothing in there about reduction in services. It's just the satisfaction.
The satisfaction survey is with current passengers, so by factor they're travelling in the service, they're not travelling because there's a reduction. But we have recently published a piece of work on motivations and barriers to rail use, and the two top ones that come across as barriers are the cost of actually using the rail service, the perceived reliability of the rail service, and the frequency of trains, and also are trains going to the places where I want to go. It's not a viable alternative compared with car or bus. If we're going to an out-of-town shopping centre or something, there's no train station close to it.
OK. Liz, do you want to add to that?
I was just going to pick up on train performance, so whether passengers are getting to the destination on time. So ScotRail is measured by the public performance measure, which is the proportion of trains arriving at their final destination early or within 5 minutes after the scheduled time. Currently, as we close out this financial year, that measure is sitting at 89.81%, which is below the target, the regulatory target of 92.5, and that was set by the Scottish Government, the Scottish Minister's high-level output specification for CP6. So there's definitely room for improvement. There has been some improvement since you last met last year, but still a good way to go to achieve 92.5.
Do you want to comment on that slightly? Because I'm slightly confused by that. If you're running less trains, which is what they're doing, and you're still not meeting the target that the government said was the reason for nationalisation, how are things getting better because of nationalisation?
So we don't. So I need to probably clarify what our role in monitoring performance in Scotland. So we are holding Network Rail, the infrastructure manager, to account. We don't hold ScotRail trains to account for their delivery. So there are elements of delay caused by the infrastructure manager, and as you know, there will be elements of delay caused by the train operator. So I can only really speak to the Network Rail element. And I think one of the big drivers in performance in Scotland, without a shadow of a doubt, is weather. Since, I mean, around end of mid-2019-2020, the trajectory for weather-related delay has increased, and it is the highest cause of delay in Scotland. So so while there are less trains running, there are still the impact from extreme weather is hampering recovery of performance and achievement of targets.
And in fairness, that's not leaves on the line. It's serious weather conditions, yeah. storms and such like, which are very unfortunately caused loss of life some years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, there are a whole heap of questions. I'm trying to remember who the next person on the list is. The next person on the list is, sorry, Mark. I think you're with the next questions.
Thanks, Kavina. Welcome back to the committee. I'd like to ask you about the off-peak all-day pilot that ScotRail have been running and will continue to run till June of this year. What are your thoughts on that? Do you think that could or should be made permanent? Do you think that that's a good use of public investment, or are there other ways to support the return of people back to the railways?
Two parts. We welcome it. Passengers like it. One, the top priority is value for money. Value for money is not just linked to the fare, but it's also linked to a good service in terms of punctuality, reliability, you know, visible staff presence. But it's definitely their lower fares, and we welcome the pilot. But I think it's got to be evaluated to see if it has delivered overall value for money. We know that it's new, so it's, the analysis on it will be very interesting. I think the Scottish Government estimated it will cost £15 million for the initial six-month project pilot, but now it's extended to the end of June. And it'll be interesting to see where the passengers are coming from. Is it existing passengers making additional journeys? Is it passengers transferring from another mode of public transport, bus, to rail, and what's the consequences for the bus funding? Mm-hmm. Are passengers coming from, because of, well, weather related, are they coming from active travel actually onto the train service because it's affordable? Are they coming from meets the government objectives? Are they coming by car? And how many passengers are actually making those journeys, and what's the impact on revenue? Is it revenue neutral? Is it costing more money for the government? So you have to evaluate it and see. But when passengers that we speak to just now welcome the off-peak, not just because it's cheaper, because it's simpler as well. Because we know that passengers who've been caught out in the past, in the east of the country, there's a morning peak and there's an evening peak, where if you're in Strathclyde, there's only a morning peak. And we know passengers travelling back from Edinburgh, oh, I never realised there was an evening peak. There's not an evening peak in Glasgow. Why is that? So that was confusing for passengers. So it makes it simpler and it makes it more affordable. So we welcome the pilot, and wanting to understand the analysis of it and the valuation to see if it can continue as part of the Fares Fair review.
Yeah.
So the ORR doesn't have a role, we wouldn't have a view on how the price of tickets are set, but the one thing I was going to add to this is that we are due to, the 21st of March, we'll be publishing some statistics on passenger numbers. The last publication didn't quite pick up the change. So we can share that with the committee. I think that could have some interesting detail in it.
That would be interesting. And do you see then the need for a simplification of the fare structures across the UK? Because my understanding is in the UK we've got some of the most complicated fare structures of rail in Europe. Sometimes the most expensive fares, sometimes fares that are very good value. But it is, I think, as you've just said, Mr. Sampson, like quite confusing for commuters and travellers to work out where that value is.
Yeah, well, yeah. I recognise that the system is complex, especially when you're travelling across Britain, different operators, etc. And simplification is ultimately good for good outcomes for passengers.
So just coming back to my original question then, is there any other way that the government, you know, would there be another option for the government to say, okay, actually we're going to subsidise some other form of, you know, price support or fare capping or whatever for the railways that might have helped? Or was this kind of a pretty obvious thing to do to move forward on removing off-peak? Sorry, moving peak time fares.
I think that would be a decision for government.
Yeah.
Yeah, ultimately a decision for government within the funding envelope, but the latest piece of work that we published, and as I mentioned in my opening remarks about motivations and barriers to train use, one of the top motivation was about cost, lower the cost, you remove a barrier and you increase rail use. So again, in that context, it'll be interesting to see the analysis and the figures that ORR put out for what is a comparison, and not just that, the numbers, but I believe Transport Scotland are doing a deeper analysis of where have they actually came from. Mm-hmm. Is it, as I mentioned earlier, additional journeys, or what mode of transport have they actually came from to make that journey? So that will be interesting to see as well, to inform government decisions going forward.
Right, thanks.
Monica, I think you've got a supplementary on this.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. Yeah, just on the back of Mark Ruskell's question, I was looking at some media comment from Stop Climate Chaos Scotland, Mike Robinson, who's a chair, and just on this issue of value and affordability, he says on behalf of the coalition that reverting to expensive tickets would be a hugely retrograde decision and would be bad news for workers, passengers and the climate. Is that something that, you know, when you're taking the temperature of the travelling public, that desire to do the right thing by the climate as well and the environment, but also have more affordable train travel, is that something that you're picking up on?
Yeah, no, our resources, passengers welcome a lot of things with fares, A, that they're affordable, B, a point we've been arguing for years, that they're easy to understand, and they're simplified, and having a window from 6 in the morning to midnight where there's no peak restrictions, where it's the same price throughout the day, is easy to understand. So in those areas, that is definitely welcome. Yes.
Great, thank you.
Now, just because of the way things have panned out, I'm actually going to bring Jackie in, because you've got a question that you wanted to ask, and I'll go to you, and then I'll come to Douglas Lumsden afterwards. Jackie.
Okay, thank you, and good morning, panel. Yes, it was to go back to what Liz was saying earlier about weather disruption, and we're seeing an increase in extreme weather happening. Can I ask, how satisfied are you that Network Rail and the train operators have got the required skills needed and also the resources to cope with what is an increasing disruption?
Yep. So, rightly recognised, it's a major challenge for Network Rail in Scotland. Since Carmont, there has been a huge focus, particularly from Network Rail, on what steps are needed to sort of improve resilience of the network, and that's both operational aspects. So, for example, having dedicated weather meteorologists in the control room to kind of try to predict the weather and understand what the right course of action is for the railway. There's also a dedicated helicopter, which they use to do aerial surveys and sort of, the condition of earthworks. And then for Network Rail's plans for the next control period, so we're just about to start that. That starts from April this year, the next five-year funding cycle. There's around £500 million in Network Rail's plans to cope or for climate change work. There's also quite a significant document produced by all of Network Rail's regions, but with a sort of scrutiny on the Scotland one. It's a 70-page document which sets out their approach to climate change adaptation and resilience. And that is, in some aspects, it's future-proofing the railway. So, for example, when Network Rail goes in to do a drainage renewal, they might fit a bigger catchment to predict, unfortunately, the rainfall will be greater in the future. So there's lots going on. Lots going on. Isn't the same in the operator space as well? If I can speak better to the network rail side of things.
So you're confident with what is being put in place?
Yeah, yeah. We think that particularly the network rail, the climate change adaptation plans for CP7, we think they're credible, yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Jackie. The next question is from Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener. I was just going to ask one question about the peak fares first, if that was okay. I was listening to a radio phone in yesterday, and most people said it was a good thing. But one person did call up and say that it was the worst thing that's happened because now her train is jam-packed at peak times because people obviously don't have to, are changing some of their behaviours. So, Robert, is that something that you're seeing as well, and did the government maybe need to look at their timetable and because of the change?
Yeah, when the peak fare trial started in October, I had meetings with ScotRail about what you're going to do if trains are crowded in the morning, more passengers are travelling before 8 o'clock. They said we have to monitor it, but this is brand new. We don't know what areas passengers will come from. Will it happen in Fife? Will it happen in the north? Will it happen in the west of the country? And we'll have to look at it and move our train sets around accordingly. And talking to the train performance people at ScotRail, there has been one or two instances of crowding, but not to the extent that, not that they predicted, they didn't know, and they're trying to move carriages around to suit, but there's a limited amount of trains. Most of them are out in the morning, so there's a limited amount of what they can do. But if this policy pilot has to be adopted long term, then the timetable has got to reflect that. Where are the passengers coming from? Do we have to improve the frequency and service in that route, or do we have to have longer platforms to have longer trains? So there are solutions to a welcome problem of more people wanting to use the network. But in saying that, you know, passengers in Scotland, you know, it was quite not ironic, I suppose, but we did a piece of research a few years ago. Passengers in Scotland expect a seat on the train, where in the south they're more willing to stand. They expect the space to stand. And I thought, oh, but yeah, they've got to have seats for passengers in Scotland.
No, you know, you're right. It is a good problem to have. Other question I was going to ask about, you know, as a committee, we've heard concerns that passengers cannot access the cheapest tickets through apps or vending machines at stations. We've also heard concerns about potential ticket office closures. So I'm just trying to think, what is the future of rail in terms of vending and how we procure our tickets? What would you, if you had a crystal ball, what would you think we're going to be doing in the future?
Mix and match to what the passenger actually wants. We went through a consultation 2 years ago in Scotland about the ticket office, about changes to ticket office opening hours. The Scottish Government is still to make a decision on that and how they're going to take it forward. But I was involved, there was a large consultation last year in England about almost every ticket office, and we got feedback from about 750,000 consultation responses. And ticket vending machines have got to be easy to use, they've got to be understandable, they've got to also actually meet the needs of passengers with disabilities. A lot of passengers do appreciate apps and mobile technology, but again, due to the complex nature of the fare system, a lot of passengers seek the reassurance of talking to someone on the train or someone at the station about the best value ticket they have for their journey. So until you actually simplify the fare structure totally, you've got to have a staff presence to actually help passengers.
And is it a case where you may get a cheaper ticket using the app as opposed to a vending machine, or is that mainly because you've maybe purchased ahead of time, or...?
On the ticket vending machines, some ticket vending machines, you can buy advance tickets, but Most passengers use ticket vending machines to purchase on the day they're actually travelling, or to pick up tickets that they've actually booked in advance and they can get from a ticket vending machine. Internet apps and at the station, again, it's a mixture. You can buy tickets on the day, or you can use the app to buy a ticket in advance and maybe get a cheaper ticket. But ticket vending machines would be more expensive because most passengers use it to purchase tickets on the day rather than for travelling 4 or 5 weeks' time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I guess that's what we were saying earlier. Maybe it should be simple. The fare structure should be simplified so to allow people to...
Yes, and if you're going to a station to buy a ticket four or five weeks in advance, most passengers want to speak to someone in a travel centre rather than go to a ticket vending machine for that type of purchase, because they feel reassured and they'll get the best information from the ticket clerk. Mm-hmm.
Liz, that's probably out with your scope, is it? Or?
Well, no, I would agree with the comments. So, I mean, I use the Scotrail app. I buy the ticket in the morning. I'm usually running late and it works for me, but it's not going to work for everyone. And then I agree fully with Robert's sentiment that there has to be solutions for everyone, that the railway has to be accessible to all. And that's what, or from an ORR perspective, we would make that, that's our sort of focus in accessibility and passenger information. So I would agree.
Mm-hmm. I guess, though, that... If you know, if you've got an app, you're probably more likely to get a cheaper ticket because you may book in advance, as opposed to people who maybe elderly, for example, don't have that confidence and always will go to the ticket office just as the train's going, and they would probably potentially pay more.
Yeah, that's potentially right. You know, if you have the internet, you have the app, you can book a ticket 6, 8, 10 weeks in advance, where if you're at the station, you have to go to that station 8, 10 weeks in advance to speak to the ticket clerk to get that. It's easier for a lot of people to use the app or internet, and more difficult to get to the station. It all depends where you live as well, to make that journey to actually inquire about booking a ticket.
Okay. Thanks, Camino.
Okay, thanks, Douglas. The next questions come from Bob Doris. Bob.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I just go back a little bit to dig beneath the statistics in relation to performance and satisfaction, if that's okay? First of all, good news. We're not there yet, but both are improving, so that's positive. But I do note in relation to performance, ScotRail will often contend that two-thirds of the reasons for delays are matters out with their control. So getting to a figure of 91.2% compliance is relatively positive, but of course we don't know what the figure is if you were to strip out failings with Network Rail or trespassing on the line or adverse weather. So do we report on this in performance by stripping out the matters that it would not be reasonable for ScotRail, or they're not able to deal with directly, to see what their performance is as a Scotland's national operator now in public control, because I'm not sure that's reported on anywhere.
We do try to report on sort of Network Rail cause delay, and it's called talk on talk, so the delay the operator causes. I do have the statistics here. I think Network Rail is currently causing about 54% of delay on the Scottish network. We don't strip out the Network Rail cause delay because it's a whole industry measure. So we know that Network Rail will cause some delay and that the operator inevitably will cause some delay. But it's about reducing the portion of delay, or reducing the types of delay that each is causing to get performance in a better place, if that makes sense.
It absolutely does make sense. But what I was wondering, Convener, was I think we've got a current situation where ScotRail is doing pretty good. Yes, it has to do better and things are improving. But where the statistics show they need to do better, sometimes that will actually be Network Rail needing to do better and not ScotRail. Sometimes it will be severe weather as opposed to ScotRail. So it would seem to make sense to have a performance statistic based on the matters that ScotRail can directly control. That's not just so the numbers look better for ScotRail, because in a few years' time, Ms McLeod, because of a situation where Network Rail gets its act together and does a lot better, and performance actually improves, but ScotRail's performance could theoretically diminish, and that would be masked by an improved performance by Network Rail or with a particularly mild winter. So it's how we report in a way where we can actually hold Scotland's national train operator to account or to commend it for improved performance. That seems to be the current situation. So do we get any stripped out data reported on consistently?
So we get lots of data. There's
no shortage of data.
There is a measure that we used, again, with my ORR hat on with the Network Rail. Because you're right, we have to understand what level of delay Network Rail is causing, and there is a metric that allows us to do that. It strips out the delay and it kind of focuses in on Scotland Network Rail, and there'll be targets for that level of delay, and if Network Rail's achieving target, basically that will enable achievement of the 92.5% PPM target. We don't have, so we obviously don't regulate the operator, but what I would say is one lesson that we're probably learning from the past year since public ownership is should we be interacting more with ScotRail Holdings, so the company that sits above ScotRail, and kind of appropriately challenge each other on whether, from a regulatory point of view, we're taking the right action, whether there's more to do. So that's something we've kicked off with ScotRail Holdings, and I think that will help us understand each other's position and challenge and improve where we can.
That's very helpful. Mr Sampson, before I move on to my next line of questions, do you have any reflections on how I know for the passenger, they just want trains to run on time, on schedule, and get to where they want to go efficiently and comfort, and delighted they're more likely to get a seat here in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK, but we still have to improve the passenger experience. Of course we do. Do you have any reflections on whose fault it is or whose responsibility it is, why there's been delays? Any reflections on that, or are you just focused on the overall passenger experience?
It's an overall passenger experience, but what is infuriating for passengers when you sit on a train and the train's delayed and there's an announcement, this is not a ScotRail fault, this is due to Network Rail. A passenger, I don't care whose fault it is, work together, like Lower are trying to do, get Network Rail, Scottish Rail Holdings, ScotRail, Transport Scotland, all together, deliver the high-level output specification for the railway, which they've did, and hopefully there's a clear trajectory in Network Rail's delivery plan when they publish it later this month for CP7 that will show how Scotland's railway in its totality will get to 92.5% PPM, which is the target. And if you do that, you'll improve the passenger experience, and this passenger satisfaction figures that we produce should go up, because the biggest driver of passenger satisfaction is reliability and value for money.
Absolutely. Just moving on to my next line of questioning. I want to ask about accessibility for Scotland's rail network for passengers. And doing so, I should point out that a recent visit to Springburn Station, my constituents, which fingers crossed it will get access for all funding to get this put in. If you've got a small show, as I have, it's more of an assault course than it is a train station. So I'm conscious accessibility can be for families with small children, for disabled passengers, for lone females feeling safe to use the network. In the last year, is there any reflections that either Ms McLeod or Mr Sampson wants to make in the accessibility of Scotland's rail network more generally? I'm not directing to any of those particular aspects, but any observations you want to make before we move on to the next line of questioning? Maybe Ms McLeod?
Yep. So again, just focused on Network Rail, and that you mentioned access for all. So we are in a sort of a position where, because we regulate the whole of Britain's railway, we can compare against how other regions within England and Wales are doing. And Scotland's Network Rail Scotland is actually doing really well in terms of its delivery of access for all projects. We are aware there's projects ongoing, like in Annie's Land. We've seen really good progress. And as well, the other element I was going to touch on is tactile paving, so the raised paving in the platform. I've got some statistics. So Network Rail, so there's 148 stations to be upgraded, their tactile pavings to be upgraded. So far they've done 140. 148 has to be delivered by March 2025, so that they're well ahead of progress on that. So it's quite a good news story.
Okay, thank you. I won't indulge myself asking questions about the local rail network. I'll leave it with yourself there. Ms McLeod, Mr Sampson, any reflections on accessibility for passengers in the rail network?
Yeah, we know, again, from Network Rail's strategic business plan, that they're looking at developing an accessibility strategy, a better accessibility strategy. It doesn't just look at the infrastructure, but looks at it from the passenger experience, not just at the station, but how do they get to the station? The whole, kind of from a start to finish journey point of view, rather than just the operational hardware that should be, if you look at it from the passengers, but also, if you know that although there's less passengers travelling now on the network compared to pre-pandemic, the number of passengers needing passenger assistance is roughly only about 2 or 3% lower than pre-pandemic. For an ageing population, there's more passengers booking passenger assistance. So again, I mean, it's looking at how you actually deliver passenger assistance 100% of the time, how the handover is from the departing station to the station you arrive at, how the handover is applied to the person on the train, the ticket examiner or the train guard. We know that, again, we talked about from ticket, there's a use of passenger assist apps that operators use now as well, so that the chain from one member of staff to another isn't broken and the passenger's left frustrated on a train, can't get off or at a station, can't get on. And we know that with the new rolling stock procurement that's coming down the line, one of the key specifications for new trains is to have level boarding at all stations. It would help in that matter as well. So that would be welcome, but that's some years off.
Before my colleagues come in, I did mention Springburn Station. It's not about Springburn Station, but when I was there for a site visit, this is the bit rather than the station itself. Scotland's Railway was there rather than Network Rail or ScotRail, so both were represented, as was SusTrans, as was Glasgow City Council, as was a local charity that I'm also a trustee of who are interested in town centre regeneration. So there seemed to be, jury's out whether that will bring the positive outcomes that we all want, but there seemed to be much closer collegiate partnership working than maybe I've seen before. Is that something that you're aware of, Ms McLeod, or was I just fortunate on that particular day?
No, I think that's probably a good reflection. I think, Alex Hines is that he's the MD of the ScotRail Alliance, and I think there is good, we see it in the performance space in particular, there's really good engagement with both the operator and the infrastructure manager to try to challenge each other. What's wrong with performance? What do we need to do to improve? I think that's a fair reflection.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. The next questions are from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you, convener, and again, good morning. Just want to pick up on the issue of accessibility before I move on to questions I want to ask about safety and for women and girls in particular. Bob Doris asked about accessibility, and Robert, you talked about rolling stock procurement and I suppose future opportunities. And I'm in committee, I'm patron of Disability Equality Scotland, but I just wanted to ask, even at this quite early stage, is there positive engagement with disability organisations and disabled people about their experience now? And also, you talked about not just reliability, but perceptions around reliability. And I think that point about passenger assistance is obviously a key one. So just to get a brief answer on that before I move on to other matters.
The rolling stock procurement programme is still to be rolled out, but we have spoken to Transport Scotland, Scottish Rail Holdings and ScotRail, and the procurement teams there, saying that the procurement has to be informed, not just about the lump of metal that will transport passengers, but actually what's going to be on board in terms of seating, in terms of toilet provision, in terms of information systems, in terms of luggage space, in terms of wheelchair space, and that can only be informed by asking the people affected, such as we've got a range of insight that we've done with other operators and what passengers wanted to see in terms of the interior features of a new train, and there's also talk to organisations such as Disability Equality Scotland, the Mobility Access Committee for Scotland. They can all inform the plans, and so that you get a new train that works from day one in terms of what the passengers want, rather than having to retrofit it later on because you haven't thought of that issue to begin with. So let's get it right from the start. And I'm speaking to Transport Scotland, ScotRail, Scottish Rail Holdings. There's a willingness to engage in that to make sure that the specification is correct, because those trains will be on the network for 20, 30 years, so we have to get it right.
Yeah, well, that's encouraging to hear, because it's important to build that in very early on to inform specification for procurement. So thank you for that. So, yeah, I wanted to come back to the point about safety. So we know from your own research with passengers that you hear a lot that passengers like and value having staff around. And research published last year by Transport Scotland into women and girls' safety found similar things. The rail unions continue to express concerns about antisocial behaviour and violence in Scotland's rail network, but in particular how that impacts on women and girls. And I should also remind the committee that I'm a member of Unite the Union and a member of the RMT parliamentary group. So just with that sort of background here, just to get a sense of what you think is happening around antisocial behaviour, the discussion around the safety of women and girls, because we know that Transport Scotland's report recommended increasing station staff. Is that something that you would agree with? And what practical steps can be taken to improve safety and to tackle unacceptable behaviour?
There's a lot of issues involved in that. From all our research over the years into personal security or safety, whether it's at a station or on board a train, passengers welcome a visible staff presence. Whether that's someone walking through the train or whether that's someone at the station. The adoption of travel safety teams that ScotRail have introduced are to be welcomed. It's also about good lighting at the stations. It's about adequate car parking, where there's room for car parking. It's about safe walking routes. There's CCTV and help points at every station. One of the things that come through from our research with passengers, but are they monitored in real time? Well, in Scotland, they actually are, but it's getting that message across to passengers that can give reassurance. So, although there's a CCTV camera, they don't actually know that someone's looking at it in real time. Will it be checked tomorrow morning for evidence if something goes wrong, rather than be proactive in helping me? Issues like that. And it's also about stations and trains being clean and well maintained. You know, there's a lot of community groups in Scotland help at stations, and it gives that sense of, well, this is well looked after. If there's just small things like planters, or if a station needs a coat of paint, that it's done, rather than if a station looks unloved or uncared for, that gives a perception that it's not a safe environment. So there's a whole range of issues associated with that. No, ScotRail aren't going to, or Network Rail aren't going to get any plaudits for keeping the station clean, because that's what passengers expect. Yeah. It's the basics, and the same as the train. But it helps to foster a safe travelling environment, as does it major events. If there's a visible staff and British Transport Police presence after sporting events or after cultural events. And also passengers are also reassured that stations with other passengers being there as well. So there's a whole range of issues that there's not one silver bullet that actually make it a safe journey.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. You're giving lots of examples there, and I think that point about communicating to the public that the CCTV is monitored in real time, I think that's an important message. In terms of the experience of women and girls who have experienced sexual assault or sexual harassment, have you got any up-to-date, you know, kind of views on that? Is that a situation that's getting worse, better, staying the same? And this point about staff and invisible staff, and do you recognise that has to be part of the solution?
Yeah,
Yeah, visible staffing has to be part of the solution. That's what the research, not only in Scotland but across the whole of Great Britain, shows that passengers in terms of personal safety, that's an issue. It has to be addressed. Also, on passenger priorities, the top 10 priorities, I think number 6 and number 8 is personal security for all passengers on train and at stations. And we did a piece of work last year, which I'll write to the committee about, but it was Birmingham. It was about perceptions of safety for women and girls travelling in Birmingham. But there was a lot of the same issues arise there from the issues of the Transport Scotland report that was published last year about women and girls travelling safely.
Okay. I know that I think Mark Ruskell wants to come in on this theme as well, but just to pick up on another point about staffing. So, as I understand it, around 2/3 of ScotRail stations are unstaffed, which appears to be higher than the UK average of around 45%. And over half the Scottish network is operated via driver-only operation. And whilst there's always a second person rostered on services, there's no guarantee there'll be a second person on board all services. There's currently proposals by ScotRail to extend driver-only operation to the Barrhead and East Kilbride lines, and I'm not sure about other areas. So, again, there is appears to be a bit of a difference between the rest of UK and Scotland on that. Is that something that you can speak to? Do you have a view on that?
There probably was a larger proportion of unstaffed stations in Scotland than a lot of the rest of the neighbour, but it depends on the location. Northern Rail, because of their rurality and a lot of their locations, have a lot of unstaffed stations as well. And a recent report said even if a station's unstaffed, the CCTV and the help points have to be there. It's got to have good lighting. It has to be well maintained, and clean, and that gives that sense of security for passengers. As for ScotRail, we would expect ScotRail to have a second member of staff. It's in their rail contract, but we would expect a second member of staff on all trains, because again, that gives that not just a feeling of security, but for general matters such as information, selling tickets from unstaffed stations. A lot of people buy their ticket on board. We would want a second member of staff on every train.
There's no guarantee at the moment that that happens. Do you think there should be a guarantee that a second person is on the train?
A second person should be rostered, and we would expect that to happen on all occasions, because that helps us for not just security or a feeling of safety for passengers, but also the other aspects about information. Right. About selling tickets and helping with accessibility as well.
Right, so just like, is that an area for improvement then?
It's an area for improvement, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Mark, you wanted to come in on the back of that.
I think that broadly covers it. I was just going to ask you though if you had any feedback from passengers using driver-only operated routes. Have there been particular concerns in terms of antisocial behaviour or feeling of insecurity if there isn't that additional staff on the train to support people?
That hasn't come through.
Okay.
That hasn't come through. It's having that second member of staff on board with the uniform on, going through, reassuring passengers. People in the know will know, is that a guard who's responsible for opening the doors, or that's just a ticket example, but most passengers, it's a second member of staff helping me, there to sell tickets, there to give me information, there to help passengers with accessibility needs, whatever their job title was. So passengers look at it just from that second member of staff point of view rather than the duties of that person.
Yeah, okay, yeah, thanks.
I'm just smiling slightly to myself when you talk about a second passenger, a second member of staff on some of the railway stations on the North Line. You still have to hail the train if you want it to stop at your station. I think the staff numbers are quite light. Douglas, you want to ask a question?
Yes, it's just continuing the theme on safety, and
concerns raised by the trade unions, and that was around the HST rolling stock, the Class 43s. And just to ask if you have any, well, both your organisations have any concerns on the continued use of the HST trains.
So we, if at ORR, if we had concerns about the safe use, you know, if we thought there was an imminent threat of danger, we would have served a prohibition notice to stop the trains running, and we haven't done that. So hopefully that kind of answers your question from a health and safety perspective. We are also monitoring. There was a number of recommendations made as part of the sort of recommendations from Carmen, looking at the HSTs to see if there's you know, a better way of. It looked at the driver's cab. It's looking at tables, and there's some quite specific aspects. Again, we observe those groups, and we are happy with the progress that's been made. So hopefully that helps.
Okay. And Robert, did you have?
No, nothing to add to that point.
Because I think in the report it did say that the outcome could have been better if it was a more modern train as opposed to the HSTs. Was that not correct?
I think Rabe recognised that unfortunately, if there was another train used, the outcome would have been the same. Again, going back to the Carmen incident, it was the drainage that was at fault that caused the accident. I think that the Rabe don't. They say another train would have had the same outcome, unfortunately.
Okay, thanks, Camino.
Mark, I think you've got a question you want to ask now.
Yeah, it's about the decarbonisation programme and the objective of effectively decarbonising Scotland's railways by 2035. Do you see that as being on track given current levels of investment?
There's enabling works being done in sort of sort of feeder stations to make sure that the network is capable of supporting future electrification. I think it would be, you know, sort of Transport Scotland are responsible for specifying and funding the enhancement projects that will be needed to deliver electrification in the future. I think we would need them to answer whether it's on track. The thing I was going to add to the question, though, is that there's lots going on elsewhere. So Network Rail's plans for Control Period 7, there's carbon emission reduction targets. There's lots of, throughout this control period, we've seen good work between ScotRail and Network Rail on just simple things like recycling, reducing pollution at stations, etc., etc. So that's ongoing. And there's also some biodiversity work as well, and some targets associated with carbon reduction and biodiversity in the next control period. So it's an area of focus from a regulatory perspective. Mm-hmm. The enhancements that will be needed to future electrify the network, I think that is a question for the funder. The other thing I was going to add in is that there's a good focus across Britain now on freight growth. And obviously, modal shift is really important. Mm-hmm. And the more product you can get on freight trains, the better. So there's now targets. So in the last control period, the last 5 years, we only had a target in Scotland. And that target is... So the Westminster, their specification for CP7 included a freight growth target for all of Network Rail regions. And that really matters because... So, for example, if the Eastern Region and Network Rail is trying to push and grow freight, then that will benefit Scotland as well. So yeah. that's something to watch. Yeah.
Another nature of those freight opportunities is that they are regional, or that they're more about UK freight operations.
Could be a bit both. What we said in our determination was that it was really important that each of the regions set out the actions that they can take to deliver growth. Do recognise that the economic conditions are tricky at the moment, but there are definitely steps that Network Rail can do to incentivise new entrants into the market, etc. So there's regional plans, but there will be national things that can be done on the timetable, for example, as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thanks, Mark. I'm going to come to you, and then I'm going to go to the Deputy Convener, Ben, to wrap it up at the end. Monica.
Thank you. Just a final question for Liz McLeod on Control Period 7. We've heard from rail unions that they're concerned that a reduction in the level of investment in renewals by Network Rail in CP7 in favour of investment in maintenance may have a negative impact on safety. Is that a view shared by the Office of Rail and Roads? And can you say what has been done to minimise any safety implications arising from this decision?
Yeah. So my answer to this question is quite similar to the HST one. So we go through a rigorous process. I mean, it's almost a year-long process, longer, if that. Network Rail submits detailed plans to us. Its initial plans, which we reviewed last summer, we didn't think they were capable of maintaining safety, and we challenged Network Rail to spend an extra, I think it's circa £50 million on structure, specifically on a specific asset. Network Rail accepted that challenge, and in finalising its plan, we deemed it to be a safe plan. Like the HSTs, if the process allows that if there's not enough funding to maintain a safe and reliable plan, which is what Scottish ministers want in their high-level output specification, then there is, the law allows, there's a process to go back to ministers to say that we would send a notification to ministers to say there's not enough money here to deliver what you want. So can you reassess and maybe take something away to afford the plan? We didn't do that. We accepted Network Rail's plans. But you're right that there are some challenges ahead. So climate change we've talked about. Mm-hmm. The other challenges with rising inflation, which that's what's kind of eaten away at the funding at the moment. And you rightly said there's going to be more maintenance and less renewals in some areas in the next control period. So what that means, so I think we're all alive to the risks. And we have worked closely with Network Rail to... So Network Rail has established a safety risk assessment model, which we wanted to use throughout control period 7, and that will provide the evidence. So inevitably Network Rail's plans will change. We do not expect a perfect plan to be delivered 5 years in advance. So things will change, and when things need to change, Network Rail needs to demonstrate to us that it's been through the decides to do less track work. Well, that track work, the decision to reduce the track work has been through that model, and we see evidence of the things that have been taken into account, the risk mitigations, etc. So, yes, less work on renewals. We're all allowed to that. There's measures been put in place for the next control period, and we will monitor that closely. And where we, where we identify issues or concerns, either from a health and safety perspective or an economic regulatory perspective, we will take action on that.
Okay. Well, that's helpful for now. Thank you.
Thank you. And now it's over to you, Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Two questions that my constituents have raised with me, but they're relevant for the whole country. The first is regarding the Edinburgh to Inverness line. It's been raised with me on several occasions about overcrowding on that line. It's such an important artery for people living in the East Coast and also in terms of tourist visitors. I wondered if that was an issue that you had any comment or direct feedback on. And secondly, with regard to reliability, the Edinburgh-Glasgow connection, particularly between Waverley and Queen Street, at periods, for example, during the Edinburgh festivals, this has been extended later into the night, which is a good thing. But I think there's a strong argument, and so do many of my constituents, for this to happen on a more regular basis so that people can go to concerts, football games, and be able to come home later. Is this something that's been raised with you and part of your considerations in terms of your feedback?
On your second point, goodness. There was a consultation exercise on the ScotRail franchise back in 2012 when the first group were ending the franchise, and we went out and asked passengers in terms of timetable provision, what would you like to see? And what came back, and it comes through from most franchise consultation exercises we hold with passengers, that we'd like to see more early morning services then and more services late at night as well, to allow for the 24-hour economy and for cultural events. So, yeah, there's a definite feedback from passengers for earlier and later services. But again, that would probably eat into the time to you can actually maintain and renew the network and control period, and it would have costs. But from a passenger perspective, we'd like to see later night services. And ScotRail did that to a certain extent on a Friday night when it was Abellio, it took over the franchise, and that's been sustained. Now it's in public ownership. feedback from passengers on longer distance services in Scotland is they would like to see faster journey times, they would like to see more carriages, and it goes back to the generic point in Scotland. Passengers want a seat and to travel in comfort on all routes, but particularly on longer journeys when there's a longer journey time. It is frustrating and inconvenient and leads to complaints and compensation when passengers get a seat on a 2-3 hour journey.
Liz, do you want to add anything?
So I'm not aware of any health and safety issues from the overcrowding perspective. I'll maybe take it away, if that's okay, just to check with colleagues in the consumer team to see if there's any trends in complaints.
Just that, particularly that line to Inverness. Yep.
Which is, of course, great interest to me, because it's the journey time to Inverness has gone up by 20 minutes, not come down by 20 minutes in the last 10 years. And there's less services on it.
Yeah. And sorry to interrupt.
No.
And I presume, Liz McLeod, what was stated by Robert Sampson around a later service between Waverley and Queen Street would not be prohibitive in terms of undertaking maintenance and all these issues. I mean, I presume it's not, given that the London Underground runs all night on a Friday and Saturday. I mean, if they can do it, we can do it, right?
So, no, I mean, it would restrict, if you changed the areas of it would restrict the time or the opportunities available for Network Rail to do its work, but it would take that into account. I mean, it's over the years we've seen, so historically Network Rail do a lot of work over sort of the New Year period, but they changed that recently to kind of reflect that people might want to go from Glasgow to Edinburgh to shop for the New Year sales. You know, the plans can be changed to adapt if that's what the best thing for the passenger is.
Great. That was really interesting. Thank you.
Thank you. And that brings us to the end of this session. Thank you very much for coming and giving evidence to the committee this morning. I think, Liz, you've undertaken to get back on a couple of points, which we look forward to receiving. I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting till 10:50 to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you and welcome back. We'll now continue our consideration of Scotland's railways by hearing from a second panel representing rail operators. I'm pleased to welcome Catherine Darbandi, the Managing Director of Caledonian Sleepers Limited, Alex Hines, the Managing Director of Scotland's Railway, Jan Maguire, the Chief Operating Officer of Scotland Rail Trains Limited, and Leon Sumpter, Route Director of Network Rail Scotland. Thank you for joining us today. I'm just going to put it on record. I think I was one of the first conveners that Alex Hines had the misfortune of coming across when he took over his position in 2017, and he is now accepted in a secondment to the Director General for Rail Services for Transport UK, I think, which is a recognition in my mind of the hard work that he's done. So I congratulate you on that appointment, and it's fitting, I think, therefore I get the last chance to have a go at you before you go. And it'll be very gentle, and Alex, I'm not going to remind you about the bridge at Dalwhinnie, except to put it on the record that you promised that it was going to be replaced, and it still hasn't. So my question is, as Jan Maguire, just about budgets. How much does it cost to run ScotRail a year? How do you go about sorting out the budget? Do you just say, well, this is what we need and that's what the government gives you? Or how does that work? Just explain that to me, if you wouldn't mind, please.
So, good morning, convener, and thank you for the question. And if only we had the opportunity to come along and say that's what we would like and be handed it to us. So there's a lot of scrutiny goes into our budget preparations, and we work collaboratively across Scotland Railway, so looking across to Network Rail and the planning that goes into their next control period, if we think about the budget year ahead. And we spend a lot of time across the business working from the bottom up in our budget preparations, looking at what we achieved last year, looking at very stretching targets, and in the first instance, our draft budget goes to the ScotRail Trains Board. It normally goes through a couple of challenging iterations in front of that board, and it will then go in front of the Scottish Rail Holdings Board before being presented to Transport Scotland. So there is a high degree of scrutiny and challenge both internally at ScotRail and through the agencies that govern us.
Okay, so I think there was a line in the Transport Scotland budget last year of about £40 million to cover the wage increases. Is that going to happen every year, or is that going to be part of the budget? How's that going to work out?
So I suppose, like all organisations across the UK, our employees haven't been immune to the cost of living increases that everyone has been impacted by. What I would say is over the past couple of years, we've worked very hard, as have our trade unions, to improve industrial relations at ScotRail. And we also need to be governed by the Scottish public sector pay policy, which we keenly await the publication of, so that that can help guide us around our pay negotiations for the coming year.
I understand all of that and I accept all of that, but I want to understand if that every time there's a wage increase, I think it was £14 million roughly for the 5% increase, is that always going to appear in a separate line in Transport Scotland's budget to cover wage increases, or will that be within your budget as a whole?
So within our draft budget, we are making a provision for pay increases, pending whatever the Scottish Government public sector pay policy we may say. We may need to review that line, but there is a line within the ScotRail Trains budget for pay reviews for the coming year.
Yeah, it's just, I'm looking at a business. Most businesses would say, well, here's my budget. If I don't have enough money, I can't necessarily just go to somebody else and ask for more money. You have to make your budget work. So there would have to be cuts in other areas to fund that thing. But it appears that you've just gone to Transport Scotland and got that money. Have I got that completely wrong?
So to be fair to our employees and the organisation, there are lots of efficiencies that we look for within our pay increases. So if I take us back to the previous year, part of the deal that we negotiated was to have our employees accept technology. Now, the organisation had been trying to achieve that for over 10 years.
I'm absolutely not disagreeing with the negotiating process. I'm just saying that you didn't have enough money, so you had to get more money from Transport Scotland to cover the pay increase. What I'm saying is that what will happen every year, or will you expect to be expected from the budget, from the money that you're getting, to be able to fund your own pay increases for your staff?
So I think Alex is going to come in, but the point I was going to make
was... He's itching to come in, through
technology, what we have done is we have increased our revenue collection by having our ticket examiners and conductors scan more tickets. And through that, we've also decreased our refund numbers on our e-tickets, as an example, which actually brings money back to our revenue line through efficiency.
I don't think 14 million, but there we go. You know,
in addition to everything that Joe's already said, obviously we manage the costs and the revenues as a commercial enterprise in the public sector. And so the first year of public ownership, the subsidy which we required was 708 million, which was actually down on the previous year at 730 million. So if ever we get any cost trends which are adverse to budget, our first instinct is to see whether we can fill that gap ourselves, efficiencies in other areas, but also revenue growth. And one of the fantastic things about ScotRail right now is it's the fastest growing train operating company in Britain. And so we're getting huge rates of revenue growth, which is helping us to reduce the cost, the taxpayer, and cover some of those headwinds that we're seeing, which have been, you know, related to inflation, which, of course, is not in anyone's control.
OK. I'll come back with some other questions probably towards the end. Mark, I think you've got some questions you'd like to ask.
Yes. So I wanted to ask you about the kind of new normal, if you like, post-COVID, travel patterns. Are we seeing a settling down of that picture now? Is the peak still a leisure-driven peak in terms of travel? What has been the impact to your services over the last year? You know, is that more of a kind of a fixed landscape now? And how are you operating within that? And I'll ask ScotRail, so ask Kelly Sleeper as well.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll go first for ScotRail and maybe bring Joe in, and then we'll hand to Catherine. So I don't think we have reached what might be described as a new normal, whatever normal is these days, because we're seeing such rapid rates of passenger growth. So we're still growing at 10, 20, 30% per annum in passenger journeys. We are the fastest growing train operating company in Britain, which is great news, because we want to see our railway busier. And for, of course, for every pound we collect through the fare box is a pound that we don't have to get from the taxpayer through subsidy. And we are about now 85% of our pre-COVID passenger numbers. So we're still 15% down on where we were before the pandemic. But that average figure hides huge changes in the market. So Saturdays are now the busiest day, which would have been unthinkable 5 years ago. And that's influencing the way that we run the business, for example, when we decide to close the railway to do engineering work. Business has recovered relatively well, but of course we know commuting has relatively collapsed from where it was just 5 years ago. And therefore the mix of our passengers has changed significantly, and that means we've had to change the way you know, we operate our railway, and our timetable reflects that. And my favourite example, of course, is we run more frequently between Edinburgh and Glasgow on a Saturday than we do Monday to Friday, because Saturdays are busier than Monday to Friday. And as I say, the passenger journeys are growing back strongly, which is great news. And in June, when we change the timetable, we add in some more services to reflect the market which is now there for rail. So you know, we're very proud that between us we're overseeing this growth. Joe, anything you want to add from a ScotRail perspective?
Yeah, so just to confirm that from June, our services will be at around 93% of the pre-pandemic timetable. And we're making improvements. We'll be excited to see Leavenmouth branch opening, making improvements across Edinburgh, Fife, Perth and Dundee, and also Inverclyde. And we're adding additional services in other areas.
Mm-hmm. OK. Catherine?
So, from a Caledonian Sleeper perspective, it's a different business to ScotRail, as I'm sure everybody appreciates. So we recovered from the pandemic quicker, faster than most other commuter talks in the UK, and certainly would be true of ScotRail. And that's because our guest base is very different. So it's probably worth just talking about a few nuances about the business. So 80% of our guests are one-time travellers and are tourists, or visiting friends and family in Scotland. So we just have 20% of our guest base is business travel, and I'll come back to that because that has changed ever so slightly. But the fortunate position that Caledonian Sleeper were in post-pandemic was we benefited in the first year from the staycation boom. So a lot of people were staying within the UK travelling. And then the second year, whilst the staycation boom tailed off a little bit, the international tourists came back. So about 20% of our tourist business is international tourism. So we recovered very, very quickly and quicker than most, and we were in a fortunate position in that regard. And we are very full. We are better than pre-pandemic levels now. Our forward revenue is 36% up. What I mean by that is money in the bank, if you like, because we sell our tickets a year in advance, which again is another nuance with the sleeper. Obviously on the commuter talks, it's 12 weeks before. So our forward revenue is 36% up. And actually on the 3rd of March, just gone, we had our biggest sales day ever. So the demand is there, and we are full to the brim pretty much every day and every night. Okay. A little bit of trend information for you. Our Highlander service, which is, as it says on the tin, to the Highlands, recovered slightly better than our Lowlander service. So our Lowlander service is Glasgow and Edinburgh. A little bit more skewed to business travel. But actually both have recovered fully now. And our business travel market, the big difference really is people would have travelled Monday, come back Friday, and we're seeing a slightly shorter week. But actually that's advantageous to us because we can sell the weekends to our tourism market. So the change in buying behaviour and travelling behaviour hasn't impacted us dramatically. Mm-hmm. But we're in a very, very good position, and we were very fortunate post-pandemic.
OK, thanks for sharing that picture. So, Alex, can I come back to you then about off-peak all day? Obviously, we're waiting for an evaluation of that.
Yeah.
We have a trial of that, obviously, running at the moment till June. But what are the figures showing at this point? I mean, is it bringing in significant numbers of new passengers? Is it just making savings for existing passengers? What is that doing in terms of both patronage and farebox income?
Yeah. So it won't surprise you to hear that, like most things on the railway, it's quite complicated to work out what the isolated impact of off-peak all day has been for two reasons. One is we're growing so fast anyway at 10, 20, 30% per annum. So what is the isolated impact of off-peak all day? But also, since we launched off-peak all day, we've had 10 named storms. We've had more named storms than ever before. And so we've got our clever people working through exactly what is the impact on revenue and patronage from a ScotRail perspective. We know it's made the railway busier. We know it's cost us money in farebox, but we're trying to work out exactly by how much. And our colleagues at Transport Scotland are doing the evaluation from a multimodal perspective. So if the railway has got busier by X%, then where have they come from? Are these new trips, or were they existing trips on car, existing trips on bus, for example? So this work is being done as we speak, and we'll provide that information to Scottish Rail Holdings and Transports Scotland, so that Scottish ministers, who of course control affairs, always have, can make a decision on what happens next.
Yeah, I mean, what would be your measure of success for off-peak all day? I mean, to put it bluntly, is there a point where, you know, more people are coming back to using the railways, there's more farebox income, and therefore, you know, the Scottish Government doesn't need to put any subsidy into this, or minimal subsidy, to support it? Is that a measure of success, or is there something?
Well, I mean, obviously, you know, we're in the business of moving customers around the country, and we want to see a growing railway. But of course, the off-peak all-day trial is a Scottish Government-funded initiative about driving other policy objectives, whether that's helping with the cost of living crisis or indeed decarbonisation and modal shift. So it's not really for us to set the success measures, because this is a Scottish Government intervention. You know, they've decided with ScotRail under public ownership to give us some extra money to drive other policy objectives. So I think whether the policy is a success or not really is a matter for Scottish Government.
Mm. Do you think it should continue to become permanent?
I've worked in railways for over 25 years, and Scottish ministers/Scottish ministers control fares, because it's a genuine trade-off. Who pays for the railway? Is it passengers or is it taxpayers? And that's a decision for politicians rather than railway managers.
Bob, you want to come in very briefly?
It is very briefly. I wonder if Mr Hines... good morning, everyone. I wonder if Mr Hines might want to comment whether there's other initiatives ScotRail have taken part in relation to grow the market of passengers. I should declare I'm a newly Club 50 member, and the £17 yep. return journeys. Yep. I did a kid for a pound.
Yep.
Journeys I wouldn't have taken otherwise. So yep. getting people onto the railway, has that been... Not that specifically, convener, but are there other initiatives that have been successful in growing the market?
Absolutely. And I'll bring Joe in shortly. But revenue generation is a key activity for us now. We're industrial action free here in Scotland. We're delivering a good service generally to our customers. And we're investing lots in revenue protection and in marketing. So it's difficult to pick up a newspaper or watch the TV or radio right now in Scotland without seeing a ScotRail advert in it. And we're about to start a new financial year, and our marketing budget goes up even further to around about £5 million per annum. We've got loads of great value offers. So we've got the Club 50, we've got Kid for a Quid, and, you know, revenue generation and giving passengers good value for money for their fare is a key part of our activity. Anything you want to add, Jo?
No, I think just the stable operating environment that we are building, and the fact that customers, are 9 out of 10 customers, are telling us that they are satisfied with our services, are giving us the platform to invest more in our marketing campaigns. Hopefully you've seen some of our Christmas campaigns on TV. We did a leaflet drop around households, you know, Kids for a Quid, you know, 4 children travelling return for a pound each with an adult is a great campaign that we will push out, especially over the summer holidays. So there are lots of initiatives that we are looking at in addition to off-peak all day.
Rather than a follow-up question, convener, I wouldn't indulge myself, convener, as you know. Ms McGuire, it'd be quite helpful maybe in correspondence to see how Scotland's Railway reports on those initiatives about how successful they have been or otherwise. It sounds very positive, but it'd be good to have some of that information from the committee to look at.
Yours is the next question.
Thank you, Kabira. So, Catherine, I was just going to ask about the Caledonian Sleeper, and what impact has it been bringing that service into public ownership?
So, it's fairly early doors for us. We're only 6 months in. We transitioned over at the end of June. Impact in the business is very little, and that's because everybody TP'd across So everybody who works in the Caledonian Sleeper, including myself, we feel very passionate about what we do, and everybody wanted to remain in the business, so everybody took it across. So on a daily basis, we're doing exactly the same, and we've got the same focuses, we've got the same team. You know, there are differences in governance, in meetings, but I think it's important to say that Transport Scotland and Scottish ministers were always our customer anyway, even in private ownership, and therefore we already had that transparent and open dialogue and meetings, conversations. So all of that continues really positively, just a few different ways of working. We are looking forward to being being able to contribute to policy. We feel we've got a lot to bring to the table, and we've just submitted our first business plan formally, which outlines our focuses for the next year. And we're looking forward to being able to plan for the longer term. We believe it'll be a more stable environment, and therefore it'll be easier to think about the longer term and doing the right things for the longer term. But it is really early doors, and actually in the business, very little change.
You mentioned that business plan. So how can we expect to see the service develop in the future?
I mean, there are... there are many aspects to the business plan. Even though we're full, I think it's important to note that 80% of our guests are one-time only travellers. So we've got a lot of focus on filling the trains every year, because we have to find those guests again each year. So making sure that that continues, the revenue growth continues positively, ensuring that our right time performance continues. We are doing extremely well. We've just hit a record high of on time performance of 87.22. So again, we don't take for granted that that will just repeat itself next year. So that's an important measure. And also guest satisfaction, continuous improvement of the guest satisfaction. Again, we're doing very well. We're sat on a rolling average of 86% against a target of 85%. It's a very difficult measure. We're proud that we're achieving it, but we don't take for granted that that will just continue. So continued focus on revenue, filling the trains, operational performance, and guest experience. In terms of wider developments, there are some initiatives looking into the longer term. For example, we have some diesel locos that run our Highlander service, and we obviously want to support the net zero policy, and we'll be looking to replace them. That's not something we'll deliver in the next year, but we'll start thinking about it in the next year. There's just some examples.
You mentioned obviously the trains are full already, so is there any ways to increase the capacity? And in terms of fares, has that sort of changed since it moved to public ownership?
No, and I'll talk about fares first. So the new trains came into service 2015, as I'm sure most people are aware, and the proposition and the fares were set at that point when the new rolling stock came into service. We haven't increased fares actually since 2020. We wanted to make sure that we did recover from the pandemic, and we've just recently increased fares for the first time. Because the trains are full, we need to keep an eye on that and make sure that what we do with fares doesn't affect demand. So that's a real balance, but we've got a very talented team in the business that look at that. In terms of, so the fares are pretty stable, and they are approved, as Alex said earlier, they are approved by Scottish ministers and government. So we recommend, but that is ultimately a decision for Scottish ministers. In terms of capacity, your question on capacity, I mean, as I said, 80% of the guests are new every year, so it's not a given that we'll fill the train every year, but we've done well for the past 3 years. There's very little capacity, if I'm really honest with you. There is some off-peak, shoulder season, winter, midweek. And we've got people looking at opportunities to fill every single cabin and every single seat. But there's very little capacity available.
In terms of subsidies, has that changed from probably pre-pandemic levels until now? Where's that gone?
It's remained fairly stable, and as Jo spoke about her budget, we're expecting that to remain stable next year. We've gone through exactly the same budget process as Jo outlined before. It's around the 40 million mark, and we're hopeful to deliver against that, the same number next year.
Trying to take it all in. So in terms of subsidies haven't reduced, capacity hasn't increased, fares haven't reduced. So I'm just still trying to work out what was the point of taking it into public ownership?
I mean, that was a decision for Scottish ministers and Scottish government. That's really all I can say on that.
Thanks, Convener.
Just to clarify, your fares do ratchet up fairly quickly, don't they, close to the day of travel. So your basic berth at roughly £120, £140 can suddenly find itself at £220 when there's a few of them available. So there are peak fares operating on Caledonian Sleepers.
So the way that we price, I mean, we sell our tickets a year in advance, as I mentioned earlier, and we've got a number of different products on offer. So we have seats, we have three grades of rooms, and then we also have our accessible rooms as well. So all of those product types are priced differently. We also offer a really excellent family price. Yeah.
Trying to get down to the fact that as you get closer to the day of travel, your prices can double for an overnight accommodation.
The way that the prices, the fares work is we dynamically price them. So we do change the fares based on demand. But a lot of our trains book up a long time in advance. But if there's very few rooms left very close to departure, then the price will be higher.
Double sometimes?
Sometimes possibly, but not as a standard. The system works on an algorithm, on learning and history, and we've got a really talented team. We also put a cap in, so we won't let it go above a certain amount.
Okay, I've learned that mistake. Sorry, Mark, if you come in very briefly with one question.
Just a quick question. I mean, the choices, Caledonian Sleepers, excellent service, but the choices are quite stark. You've got seated accommodation, or you've got a very high-end hotel-grade accommodation with ensuite. Most European sleeper services are running kind of couchette-type services, which get more people on the trains and are perhaps more affordable for more regular travellers. What can you do within that? Can you add more carriages? Can you procure more carriages? Because it feels quite a stark choice at the moment that's excluding a lot of people.
So within the realms of what we have today, there's very little that we can do without huge cost, because you'd be talking about a complete reconfiguration of the train. And what we have today was specified in 2015 and obviously approved by ministers and government. So I would say very little. Although I would say it's maybe not quite as stark as you say, because we do have some products. We have a good family product. We also have the opportunity for regular travellers to buy 10 tickets in advance, which are dramatically reduced. So we are conscious of that, and we do have some good products on offer. If Scottish Government decided they would like to allow us to procure more trains, then I think we would we would take the brief from Scottish Government, of course, but we would consider and take into account lessons learnt on the design of that. I mean, I think it's been hugely successful based on what was procured and what was set out and the mandate that was given to the business. I guess it's a conversation, a decision for Scottish Government if they wanted to bring a sleeper service in that was more aligned to what we're seeing in Europe. I mean, we watched it very... we're very interested in what's happening in Europe, but I would say what we're designed to do today is different.
Okay, Monica, I think you've got some questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. So, first of all, congratulations to Alex Hines on your new appointment as Director General of Rail Services at the Department for Transport. So, moving from Scotland Railways to Britain's Railways in just 4 weeks' time. So, I wonder if you can advise a committee who will take over from you on the 15th of April.
So obviously this news was only announced yesterday, and arrangements are in place and discussions are happening between Network Rail and Scottish Rail Holdings, and any arrangements which succeed me will be communicated before I leave.
And are you able to say, because your role is jointly MD for Network Rail Scotland and ScotRail, so will that arrangement continue?
Yeah, the alliance between ScotRail and Network Rail will continue. You know, it's widely perceived to have been a success to operate track and train together. And there's very great interest in everything that we've achieved in the last time period in Scotland. And as we know, the UK government wants to bring track and train back together on the railway south of the border. And so, you know, I'd like to pay tribute to everyone who works for ScotRail and Network Rail for all their hard work, for everything they've delivered during my time here. And hopefully I'll be able to export some of that good practice to other places.
Okay, I think it's just for 2 years, so you might be back in front of us. But I wanted to speak about the impact of weather events, and you mentioned earlier on that even during the pilot scheme for the abolition of the peak fares, there's been 10 named storms. I won't ask you to name them all, but extreme weather events appear to be having an increasing impact on Scottish Rail services. So can you update committee on how this issue is being addressed, both in the short term and in the coming years, and maybe something that Liam Sumpter could add to. Given the sort of challenges around control period 7 and sort of cuts to investment, what impact that might have on any of the actions we're about to hear from Alex Hines?
So, thank you. I will start and then hand over to Liam. So, I mean, in this 5-year control period, Network Rail has had £4.2 billion to manage the infrastructure. And in the next 5-year period, the number's about the same, £4.2 billion. So actually, a consistently strong commitment from the Scottish Government to invest in infrastructure. And what we're seeing is the impact of climate change happening quite rapidly. Mean rainfall in Scotland in the last 10 years has increased by 8%, which is quite a lot, because it was quite wet to begin with in some parts of the country. And of course, our railway was primarily built by the Victorians when the weather was very different. And therefore, whilst we've been putting our business plan together for the next 5 years on the infrastructure side, we've specifically targeted additional investment in those railway infrastructure assets which are vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, structures, embankments, drainage, etc. So actually, £400 million in the next 5 years will be spent to make the railway more resilient. Obviously, we had the tragic accident at Carmont on the 12th of August 2020, and quite rightly, since that date, we've been applying more precautionary speed restrictions to keep our passengers and staff safe when we get adverse and extreme weather. And we've done a whole host of really good work there to make sure we can run a safe and resilient railway. So, for example, we've invested more in infrastructure, and particularly our knowledge of our drainage assets. We've modified the trains. As I say, we now apply precautionary speed restrictions more often, but also our control centre on the outskirts of Glasgow is the first railway control centre in Britain to have full-time 24/7, 365 days a year meteorologists. And that's helping us learn the impact of weather on our network. And as we've got better at running what I would regard the basics of railway operation, both in ScotRail and in Network Rail, which is underpinning our improved punctuality over the last 12 months. this growing impact of weather is a headwind which is pushing us in the other direction. So there's no question that we need to spend more time, effort and investment on this issue. And so it's good to see that in the Network Rail Scotland business plan, which starts on the 1st of April, we've got an increase in investment in those type of assets, which should hopefully mean we don't have to apply these precautionary speed restrictions as much. So, for example, we've just completed a multi-million pound project on the Edinburgh-Glasgow line, which means under extreme rainfall events, we don't have to apply a speed restriction at all, because we've made the asset so resilient. So sometimes our response is to go in and invest in the infrastructure, make it more resilient. Sometimes we use softer measures like precautionary speed restrictions, and we're rolling out all sorts of clever technology across the network. So, for example, earthworks failure detection systems, which we are probes which sit in the side of they sit in the sides of embankments, and they detect movement, which can be a precursor to a landslip. So there's lots of really good work happening in this space, and Joe, Liam and I sit down with all four trade unions every quarter, and we take them through where we are with each of those recommendations. We've made some good progress in this area, but I agree with you that the impact of weather is significant. It's disruptive for our passengers and indeed our staff, and we need to do more to tackle that growing problem.
For Liam, that, anything so you'd yeah, like keen to hear to Liam, and obviously you mentioned there resilience on some routes will be more challenging than others because of issues around drainage and other factors. So maybe Liam could maybe expand on that briefly.
Yeah, okay, thank you. And good morning, committee. Alex's answer was quite extensive and covered a lot of what I would have mentioned. But I'll pick up on a couple of points. The technology point is really important because of the size of Scotland's railway, using people to go and look at what's happening all the time is not safe, and it's very labour intensive. So we're using more and more technology. Alex mentioned the tilt meters that measure whether the embankments are slipping. If you're travelling about on Scotland's railway and you see these little yellow poles, they're about a metre high, sticking out of the bank, that's what they are. And they're installed at over 100 sites now, so you'll be able to see that yourselves. We've also added technology at things like bridges to measure scour. So scour is when water erodes old structures around the bottom of bridges. So we've done that at 25 of our key scour locations, and we're using the helicopter more and more as well. So we've got a dedicated Network Rail helicopter that can go up with cameras on the front. That actually, the camera on the front of the helicopter costs more than the helicopter, such as the technology in that camera that really identifies, can see very, very small things that might interfere with the railway. So that can spot landslips early, because sometimes they come from quite far away from the actual railway itself, so people travelling on the railway wouldn't see them. It also detects different levels of heat, so we can see whether there's something happening around electrification assets and things like that. But to your point, some lines of route are harder to tackle than others. So the West Highland line in particular is very, very challenging to tackle because it's a railway built very close to mountains in some cases. The topography is very challenging. And of course, it's the wettest part of the UK. So some parts of the West Highland line saw more rain in a day in October than Glasgow would see in an average October, the whole of October. It's very, very wet. So we have to target our mitigations quite carefully to try and make sure that we can do as much as we possibly can to benefit as many passengers as possible, but at an affordable rate as well, because some of our measures, they are expensive. Infrastructure measures can be very, very expensive, so we need to target them accordingly. And where we can't do the immediate infrastructure fix, that's when we can apply operational restrictions, such as speed restrictions. And we're trying to target them to locations that are the most sensitive and there's the most risk, so that we don't disrupt passengers unnecessarily.
Well, there's a lot to comment on. We don't have time, but in my head, I'm just wondering in terms of some of those operational restrictions, like on speeds, if that's going to be something that we'll see more of. But and the helicopter, that's new information for me. So thank you for that. I'll come back to Alex. You said that Scotland Railways are industrial action free, but I'm aware that the RMT is balloting tomorrow. Balloting at ScotRail members on the proposed extension of driver-only operation, so possibly quite timely that you're here. I just wondered why this issue in Kintyre continues to be a problem. Unions are saying they fear that driver-only operation has been brought in by the back door. So I know you care about having good industrial relations. So what has been done to address this, and will Scotland continue to be, or Scotland Railways continue to be, industrial action free? I don't know if Alex or Joanne are best to speak to this, but perhaps both.
I'll start and then bring Joe in. So, I mean, the first thing to say is that the constructive relationships that we have with our four trade unions in both businesses is absolutely critical to us underpinning that the service that we provide. And, of course, they represent our people who do a fantastic job every day and every night to deliver a fantastic rail service. That's not going to change. Where we have disagreements, we continue through dialogue to try and resolve those disagreements. And, of course, we're committed to having two people on board every train. There are, in the west of the country, we tend to operate services on a driver-only only basis with a ticket examiner on board. And in the east of the country, we tend to have a driver and a conductor on board. And what we find is if we allow the drivers to open and close the doors, that's really good for visibility for customers. It's good for revenue collection, etc. So both of these are safe methods of operation, as we call it. So one of the things that we're doing with the investment we're getting from the Scottish Government is to electrify some lines in the west of the country. So we recently completed the electrification of the Barrhead line. We're completing the electrification of the Glasgow to East Kilbride line between now and December next year. And so we're talking to our relevant trade unions about the method of operation on those routes, and hopefully we'll be able to resolve those differences without the need for any industrial action. Jo, anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, so the ballot does open tomorrow. However, our door is still open as well, and we are still in discussion. It's a really interesting situation because this involves RMT and ASLEF, and ASLEF are in fact supportive of the changes that we want to make. We find RMT in opposition, and as opposed to pushing a change through the back door, what I'd say is we had wanted to implement this change in December when the newly electrified line was opened, but because of concerns that unions had raised, we agreed to delay the implementation of the change to allow for further consultation and negotiation on what we intend. We have guaranteed the employment of all of the conductors because there are other services running out of Glasgow Central where they are based that we can deploy them on. And in fact, rather than services being unsafe, we have evidence that we can actually provide better value for the taxpayer by improving revenue collection and ensuring that the second person on the train is there visibly to better defend against antisocial behaviour and provide passenger assistance should it be required. But the key factor is we are guaranteeing the employment of the conductors, and we're committed to delivering a second person on every train.
Okay, I mean, it sounds like there's a way to go here in terms of getting everyone around the table. So just so I've got this right, so the Scottish Government's position is that it specifies a requirement that all ScotRail services should have a second staff member on board to assist passengers. I think that RMT appear to be concerned that there's going to be discretion and that will be for the train driver to make that decision. I think they feel that there'll be pressure on the train driver. Am I getting that correct?
Conscious of time, and happy to have a follow-up discussion or correspondence if required. We operate just now where the fleet is enabled, that the driver will open and close the doors. There is always a second person rostered on those services, mm-hmm. but if at short notice that person isn't available, then the train will run. What we're suggesting is that could that would remain in place, and ASLEF are accepting because that's a current practice and it's safe to do so.
So we do not plan to run trains, but if there is a short notice cancellation, it would still be safe to operate a service without the second person. But as part of these negotiations, and as an ongoing matter since we've come into public ownership, we have been working hard to close the vacancy gap at ScotRail, which helps us deliver the guarantee of a second person on the train.
Okay, I think we would appreciate more information. It's obviously a live issue, and I'm not entirely sure what the business case is, but there's the commitment on rostering, but then there's no guarantee of that second person. I'm not sure how often there won't be a second person, but yeah, I'll leave it there for now, convener.
Okay. Now, can I just say to members, I am really struggling. A lot of you want to come in on supplementary questions. The clock is against me. If you want to come in on supplementary questions, some members aren't going to get questions, so that's going to be difficult. So I'm going to stick with the list that we've worked out, and I would ask members to keep their questions short and, where possible, the panel to answer as succinctly as possible, which I'm sure they'll say they've done already. So the next questions go to Bob Doris. Bob.
Thank you, convener. So I'm going to roll two or three questions together for brevity purposes, convener. So it's about purchasing of new rolling stock and opportunities within that. So perhaps witness could set out how ScotRail and Caledonian Sleeper will go about procuring new rolling stock in the future. So, for instance, we'd like to know, will new trains be procured through rolling stock leasing companies? I should point on record, I think I've got some dissatisfaction with that model, to be honest with you, but any issues you may have, that'd be good. Directly by operators or some other public body, but also, there was a lot in this question, how will rail users be involved in the design and layout of new rolling stock? I suppose two aspects of it, procurement, but also design and dialogue with passengers. I see Joanne Maguire and Catherine scribbling away furiously there. So I don't know who wants to come in first.
We were worried you would have three questions. So I'll come in first, if I may. So obviously on ScotRail, our fleet is actually relatively old, and it's getting older, and we operate more types of rolling stock than any other operator in Britain. And therefore, we need to invest in new rolling stock for two reasons. One is we want to remove diesel vehicles from the network, and the second is we have some trains which we need to replace because they're approaching life expiry. And so we are working with the Scottish Government on those plans, specifically in ScotRail, around the replacement of our intercity trains, and then secondly, a suburban electric train and a suburban battery electric train, which is aligned with our older rolling stock in the west of the country, which we need to replace, and the fact that we continue to electrify the network and we want to exploit the benefits of electrification to decarbonise the railway. So between ScotRail, Network Rail, Scottish Rail Holdings and the Scottish Government, those conversations are live, and we're working through the business case, both for intercity rolling stock and suburban, and hopefully we'll make some progress on that this year. I think our default assumption is that we would continue to procure trains in the way that we have done in the last 25 years, which is through rolling stock leasing companies, because they frankly put the money up, so other people don't have to. It's a market that works relatively well. But that's not to rule out any other options in terms of financing.
Could you just say, I mean, I have no concept, and I'm not sure people listening in will have, for the cost of a railway carriage or a train. You know, you'll so say...
They're very expensive.
Go on, give us a clue. So what's a carriage?
A couple of million per carriage.
A couple of million per carriage. And a train to pull it? The new version of the 125, which I seem to remember having on my railway track when I was a kid. So what's the new version of that cost?
If you take a four-car electric train between Glasgow and Edinburgh, I mean, most of the run is eight carriages, that would be £8 million for just a four-carriage train. So trains are very expensive. We have 1,000 carriages in the fleet. and we need to replace around 65% of those trains in the coming decade. So this is going to be a huge investment.
Just put it into context, and back to Bob's question.
And because... Well, sorry, go on.
I apologise, Mr Hines, for pausing you there. Yeah. One of the reasons these rolling stock operating companies, be Roscoe's by any other name, my concerns are effectively a financing arrangement with lease back, if I'm right, under previous iteration without any control from the purchaser as where the work goes to construct and maintain those trains. So there's a lack of flexibility in Scotland's railways to be able to direct some of that work to, if possible through procurement, to create and maintain and preserve jobs within Scotland. Is that a reasonable reflection?
So you're absolutely right. They are essentially a financing arrangement. So if you're not going to finance new trains through rolling stock leasing companies, the Scottish Government would have to decide where that finance is going to come from. It was very interesting recently to see Porterbrook, one of the rolling stock leasing companies, buy a stake in Brodie's at Kilmarnock, which I think is a really interesting development, because we would love for more of our work to be spent in depots and facilities based in Scotland rather than having to send trains to England and bring them back. You asked around about how the passenger will be involved. So we've agreed with officials at Transport Scotland that when we go out to procure these new trains, we will specify level boarding, which closes entirely the gap between the train and the platform, where we have a modern platform. And that will be an absolute game changer for accessibility on our railway, provide, you know, genuine turn up and go, the ability for people with reduced mobility to travel unaccompanied, perhaps. And then, of course, once we get the authority to commence the procurement, and, you know, procuring a new train takes rather a long time, we would fully consult passengers in layout. So we've already got some really exciting ideas about family-friendly spaces, for example, on board trains, which will really, you know, help grow the market still further. I've spoken for quite a long time there, I'm afraid.
Colleagues wish to come and add?
Catherine, anything to add?
Perspective, I can be really short. We're not planning to procure any additional rolling stock. We've got new trains, as we spoke about before, so I can be quite succinct.
My only other question in this area, Ms McGuire, did you want to come in and add something? My apologies.
I think we just welcome the huge opportunity to replace 11 different types of train that we currently run, potentially simplifying that both for operation and for our customers, and improvements to accessibility. As Alex said, we will consult more fully with passengers, but be reassured we have done some initial consultation with stakeholder groups.
So before we move on to my next question, just for clarity, when battery electric was mentioned, convener, that would be, for example, on the Maryhill line, where it's not electrified, battery electric could run modern trains on that line without electrification, would be my understanding. Is that the benefit of battery electric?
Yes. So battery electric trains have, you can use the overhead electrification system where it exists, and where it doesn't, it uses energy from the batteries on board the train. So on a small... On a line which is a relatively small range, like Maryhill line, that could operate using within the range of a battery. So that would enable us to decarbonise that route without any overhead electrification. In addition, we're looking initially at the partial electrification of the railway in Fife and the partial electrification of the Borders Railway. And again, having a battery electric train would enable us to decarbonise in advance of full electrification.
Economic as well, doing it that way, given the cost of full electrification. Can I just check, in terms of financing, Roscoe's would appear to be the only, so real operating companies would appear to be the only show in town because of the huge costs involved. Does government and ScotRail have the ability to knit together alternative financing arrangements, or is that just how it is?
Well, I mean, obviously, we're the buyer here, so we're free to decide how we want to finance our trains. And so, you know, alternatives are available. You know, for example, Scottish National Investment Bank might be interested. I don't know. But at the moment, our priority is making the business case with the Scottish Government to enable us to start the procurement, and then the exact financing we can work through later.
Move on to accessibility for Scotland's rail network. In the first panel, I brought up the example of Springburn train station, and myself and my small child were on a salt course than it is a train station to navigate. The good news is, and other train stations with similar issues are available, convener, but I just make the point that in that particular station, it's the second time it's made it onto the shortlist for the Access for All scheme. Decision will be by the Department for Transport in due course. It's been on that shortlist previously. Do you think that system works well, Mr Hines, in relation to Access for All, in terms of not just Springburn Station, but across the country? And are there any other comments that you would like to make about how we have to do more to make our train stations more accessible to all, not just families, wheelchair users, visually impaired and others?
I mean, it is one of the oddities of the railway structure that rail accessibility is reserved to Westminster. And we've got a strong track record of using the DfT Access for All Fund to invest in improving access for all at stations. So we've just completed Port Glasgow. We've got a number of live schemes across the country, and we want to do more. On Springburn specifically, it was great to see recently a joint ScotRail Network Rail team go to Springburn to see what relatively low cost but high impact accessibility improvements we could make there. Obviously, there's a large local college. It's also the nearest station to our control centre. So I'm sure we can do some improvements there. And recently, I was with the First Minister and the MSP for Pollock, seeing the improvements we've made at Cardonald Station. And as you rightly point out, it's not just people with accessibility needs who benefit. Everyone benefits from often these relatively small-scale investments, which can make a big difference to using the rail network.
No more questions, Convener, but for clarity and transparency, I was at the visit that Mr Hines references Springburn Station, but also put on record, it's come up in the first session, that SusTrans was also there, the college was also there, a small charity, Spirit of Springburn, that I'm a trustee of, who's involved in town centre regeneration, they were also there, Glasgow City Council was also there, so there's a real sense of proper collegiate partnership working.
Done in the last 12 months between ScotRail and Network Rail is produce a sustainable travel to stations policy, and actually someone from SusTrans was seconded into the Network Rail team, and he now works for Scotland's Railway. So active travel links to stations is a growing part of our agenda, and we're seeing that at Levermouth, where the active travel links to the stations are being built in from the start.
Thank you. The next question is from Douglas Lumsden. Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to go back to antisocial behaviour, something that Monica Lennon mentioned earlier. So it's really just to find out what more your organisations are doing to combat antisocial behaviour on our railways, and what we can do to assist. And another part of the question was, obviously, alcohol just now on ScotRail services is banned at all times of day. There was a consultation, and if you can maybe give us an update on what's happened with that consultation and where it's going to go.
So I'll start and then perhaps bring Joe in. I mean, firstly, we're doing lots of work on antisocial behaviour. As we know, during COVID, we saw an increase in antisocial behaviour, and it was a big theme which came out from our staff survey. So we're investing heavily in this area. We've created a travel safe team in the west of the country. We're on a massive recruitment drive to fill frontline vacancies, and we recently renewed our fleet of body cameras. And we've now bought many more body cameras than we used to have, because we're seeing the use of those by our staff grow. We've also strengthened our relationship with the British Transport Police, who, of course, are responsible for the policing of the network in Britain, and working with them in partnership to respond to the issues that we see, both the actual issues and also perception of security on trains and on stations. So we're working really, really hard on antisocial behaviour, and in our staff engagement sessions we're starting to notice the difference. So no doubt Joe will provide some more detail on that. On the alcohol ban, that's one of the things that really divides opinion. Everyone's got a view on it, and some people would love to be able to drink on trains, and some people are vehemently against drinking on trains. And it's for Scottish ministers to decide what they would like the policy to be on the alcohol ban. But as I say, there's no clear there's no clear winner in terms of public opinion here, and it comes back to, you know, what are the policy objectives that the Scottish Government are trying to deliver, and therefore it's a matter for Scottish ministers.
Joe? Just on that point before we move on, when I ask Scottish ministers, they say that it's up to ScotRail. You were carrying out a consultation. I think if you used the Wi-Fi, you could go in and give your views. So when does that get reported back to Scottish ministers so they can actually make that decision?
Joe, is there anything you want to add on this topic?
So, as Alex said, that was part of the feedback that we have reported back, and there is no clear winner. It's roughly around a 50-50 split on views of alcohol, and we're conscious that it is a policy decision because there's a broader impact of alcohol on society, not just the safety of our trains.
So that information went back to Scottish ministers. Can you tell us when that was, or...?
I would need to write to the committee. It has gone back to Transport Scotland.
Okay, it just my frustration is that I'm getting pinged between different places when I'm asking the questions from, obviously, yourself. You've been quite honest with where it's went, and I asked ministers, and they obviously say it's a ScotRail decision. So, okay, it's good to have that clarified.
To antisocial behaviour, not wanting to repeat what Alex has said, conscious of time, but just to confirm the body-worn cameras, we had support from Scottish Government in investing in that, and the number has gone up threefold, so we've moved from 300 to just over 1,000 body-worn cameras available for our staff, and we're actually also double-staffing trains in known hotspots. So on certain lines of route where we're seeing specific challenges, you will find two ticket examiners, especially late at night and over weekends.
And in terms of that body camera, so is that going to be, is the aim to have one for every ticket inspector, or who's going to be wearing these?
So the numbers that we have now allow for ticket examiners and conductors, so on-trained staff, and we've also made provision for staff in stations to wear them if they want to.
Okay, thank you. I'll go on to my next question, convener, because I know we're pressed for time. And we've heard concerns that passengers cannot always access the cheapest tickets through apps or ticket vending machines. So can you maybe outline your plans for the future of rail ticket vending in Scotland?
I mean, the fares and ticketing system in UK Rail is furiously complicated, as I'm sure we've all experienced. And the industry has wanted to reform that for a number of years now, but isn't able to without changes to regulation. So those conversations between industry and the UK government around fares reform continue and are a part of the plans for the creation of Great British Railways to create a simpler and better railway. Our retail strategy is to invest in what we call supported self-service. So we recently launched, the ability to buy mobile tickets on the app, for example, and we've seen a massive growth in customer numbers through the app. And actually satisfaction with the ScotRail app went up to 4.5 out of 5 customers, and indeed colleagues like it. But of course, we recognise that people also need a bit more help, which is one reason why the staffing of our railway, either on board or at stations, is a key part of our customer offer. And as Joe mentioned, the recruitment drive, which we're currently delivering in ScotRail, is making a real positive impact in this area. Excuse me.
I believe there was there a trial running at Glasgow Central with new vending machines? And can maybe explain what that was about and how successful?
There's a new vending machine there which we're trialling from one of the manufacturers.
and we're looking to see the impact of that trial on the customer experience.
And what's the difference between this new vending machine? How does it compare to the last one?
I'm not actually an expert in this area because I don't buy too many train tickets, but perhaps Joe knows a bit more of the detail.
Yeah, so what we've done is we've replaced one of our existing vending machines at Glasgow Central with this new machine as part of a trial. If you get the chance to look at it, for example, you will see that it's around half the size of the existing machine, and it actually has two screens in terms of improved accessibility. But we will be taking feedback before we make any decisions. Unfortunately, it wouldn't make the ticket purchasing any simpler due to the challenges around our ticketing regulations. But what has made ticketing much simpler in Scotland has been the off-peak all-day trial. That has made the offer much simpler for our passengers.
Okay, thanks. Can we now go on to my next question? And that's about the ongoing use of the HST rolling stock. Are these trains safe and when will they be replaced?
They are safe and they meet all the requirements for UK Rail Network. And they are on lease to us until 2030. And as I mentioned earlier on, since the tragic accident in 2020, we've made a number of changes to the way we operate the railway, including the trains themselves. And we made good progress on that, working with all four trade unions. We are also working really hard in our engineering teams to get better at the reliability of those trains, the availability of those trains and our delivery of seats to customers. And I'm really delighted to see that we're seeing good improvements there since the start of this calendar year, where the reliability, the availability and the seats to customers is improving. And it was great to have Fiona Hislop, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Transport at Haymarket last week to see that progress in action. We are working through with the Scottish Government on the business case for their replacement, and that is happening as we speak, and hopefully we'll be able to make some progress on that this year, because of course 2030 isn't actually that too far away in railway time.
Trade unions they've raised concerns about the HST trains, and you know, I was looking at the RAB report on Carmont, and they consider it more likely than not that the outcome would have been better if the train had been compliant with modern crashworthiness standards. So is that not a reason to have them replaced sooner?
So in 1994, the crashworthiness standards changed. So any rolling stock which predates 94, which is a lot of it on the UK rail network, has different crashworthiness standards. So because we've made changes to the way we operate the railway, precautionary speed restrictions, for example, we also don't operate trains in Scotland if we get a red weather alert from the Met Office. We've also invested in the infrastructure and we've modified the trains themselves. So we've done lots of work with the trade unions to improve the safety of those trains. And as I said, I sit down with them every quarter and we go through each of the 20 recommendations that the Rail Accident Investigation Branch made and where we are. And most of those recommendations are either complete or 99% complete and just awaiting sign-off from the independent rail regulator. So they are safe, but we do need to plan for their replacement.
You mentioned 2030 before replacement of the HSTs. Could they be extended further than that? Because obviously you'd probably look to have electric trains, I would imagine, on the East Coast, I'm thinking up to Aberdeen. But that's probably not going to be likely by 2030, is it, Alex?
Well, by 2030, they'll be more than 50 years old. And I would argue that's too old for a train. Trains generally have a life of between 40 and 50 years. And we're looking at their replacement rather than their extension beyond 2030.
But in terms of looking at replacement, is that going to be electric going up to Aberdeen on the East Coast line? It's probably going to be unlikely, isn't it?
That's one of the current debates. And this is where what are called hybrid trains might have a role to play. So we have a few options for replacement of intercity. We can go and buy an existing diesel train from the market, which exists in GB Rail,
or we could decide to procure what's called a diesel electric hybrid train. So, for example, a train going from Glasgow to Aberdeen could travel electrically from Glasgow to Stirling, and then we could drop the pantograph, which is the piece of equipment which collects the electricity from the overhead wire, and then proceed on diesel. So there are pros and cons, and those debates and discussions and business case work are currently being discussed between ScotRail, Network Rail, Scottish Rail Holdings and Transport Scotland. It's not easy, which is why we need to take time to go through those deliberations quite carefully.
As you say, these dates are coming quite quickly. And if I can just ask Liam, in terms of 2026, there's meant to be a 20-minute reduction between Aberdeen and the Central Belt in terms of train journeys. Is that going to be met by 2026, do you think, Liam?
I'm not sure I can answer that. I can write to you with the detail on that, unless, Alex, you're aware.
Well, I was just going to say, next week there's a meeting between ScotRail, Network Rail, Scottish Rail Holdings and Transport Scotland, where we're going through the budget for what we call enhancements on the rail network next year. And once those discussions have taken place, that we're clear about what enhancements the rail network we can deliver, including, of course, Aberdeen's Central Belt upgrade, which is a big part of our plan. So our aspirations to cut journey time by 20 minutes, improve capacity for passenger and freight, and ultimately electrify the railway remain undimmed, but obviously we need confirmation of the funding before we can proceed with those projects.
£100 million not appear on a budget line as yet.
Of asking your last question and then asking a couple of more. So, very briefly, and this is your last question.
No, I just want to know if that £200 million is in the budget.
So, I think, as we've discussed in the past, until any money passes to us in the rail industry, it doesn't become, it's not yet a funded programme. So, neither ScotRail nor Network Rail has £200 million in our budget lines to deliver that. The capital expenditure on enhancements is something that we're discussing next week, and there are a variety of options we can lay out for the Scottish Government there.
Thank you, Douglas. Mark, I think you've got a brief question.
Are we on track to meet the decarbonisation target by 2035?
So, yeah, we're continuing with the delivery of decarbonisation. We said we've already electrified the railway between Glasgow and Barrhead. We delivered that in December. We are delivering electrification between Glasgow and East Kilbride. That finishes December next year. When Transport Scotland published its decarbonisation action plan, it committed to refreshing that strategy. And my understanding is that Transport Scotland intend to publish that later this year. And that will be the result of lots of really good work between ScotRail, Network Rail, Scottish Rail Holdings and Transport Scotland on this topic. But of course, the fiscal climate has changed somewhat since then. So the ambition and the policy direction is absolutely unchanged. The plan will be refreshed later this year.
Thank you. Monica, do you have a brief question?
Yeah, I do, Convener. It's just to try and get an update on current major infrastructure projects that are hopefully in the pipeline, including the Leavenmouth rail link. But I'm also having a wee look on the STV news website. So Winchborough seems to be topical again today in terms of the new station there. Can you give an update on those two projects?
Yeah, sure. I mean, obviously, despite the financial climate from a capital perspective, as opposed to an operating expenditure where next year Scottish Government is putting £1.6 billion into the railway. We continue to invest in a bigger and better railway for Scotland. So on the 2nd of June, we will launch train services on the Leavenmouth branch for the first time since the 1960s and open two new stations at Cameron Bridge and Leaven and connect those communities to the capital. So we're also completing the electrification of the East Kilbride line, which isn't just about electrification, it's also about a brand new station at Haremise, for example, better access to the hospital, bigger park and ride. And we're talking to the Scottish Government about where we go next on decarbonisation, Fife, Borders, Aberdeen to Central Belt. We're also doing a number of smaller projects. For example, we're currently doing platform extensions on the West Hine Line, which will enable us to operate more of our Highland Explorer trains. These are the carriages which are dedicated to cycling and active travel. They can take 20 bikes on the back of passenger trains, and we're attempting to do that before the start of this year's tourist season. On Winchborough, obviously there's a big third-party developer in that part of the world, and I was lucky enough to do a site visit a number of years ago with the local MSP, who's now the Cabinet Secretary for Transport. Last year I did a piece of work for Transport Scotland on what a new station at Winchborough might look like. The good news is that in Scotland a new station costs around about £15 million. In other places new stations are £25 million, so we've done a good job of reducing the cost of new station construction. A new station from Winchborough is not in the easiest place to build. One of the sites we're looking at is in actual quite a steep cutting, and it's on the main Edinburgh-Glasgow line. So we continue to talk to Transport Scotland about the business case for that. I think the aspiration is that if there is a new station for Winchborough, there's a contribution from the developer.
Which seems fine, and there's a planning consent in principle, so not quite shovel-ready, but getting there. So, realistically, when do you expect a new station could be open for the public?
So, firstly, those decisions are are made by Transport Scotland on behalf of ministers, the investment priorities, and the capital budget for next year is still under discussion and being finalised. But it also depends how much money the developer would like to put in. So if the developer wanted to put the full cost of the station in, we're building a new station at Balgray, and it is 100% funded by the local authority. So as ever, some of this is around a discussion about who actually pays the cost of the station. Those discussions will be easier the higher the contribution from the developer is.
Okay, just so I've got this right, because it's not my parliamentary region, although I do get lots of emails about it. So there's ongoing discussion about who pays what, but it's sounding sort of less certain from what you said today, Alex, that this might not even happen. Is it definitely going to happen? Or is there a chance that because of those sort of funding issues that you've raised and some of the technical issues, not happen at all?
We've got a strong track record of delivering new stations, East Linton, Reston, Inverness Airport, Cameron Bridge, Leven. But until anyone asks us to build the station, then we won't. You know, it's not yet what I would call a funded project, and that's why the business case work. But critically, the contribution the developer is going to make to the cost of new station could potentially unlock those plans for the future.
Very briefly.
There's been a lot of studies done through the Local Rail Development Fund looking at potential for other new stations that could be delivered at relatively low cost within the existing network. Do you see the business cases building for those going forward? Do you think we're close to getting decisions despite the fiscal constraints the government has?
I think there's two things we can do in the rail industry, which is grow revenue as fast as we can, because that improves the business case for any new station, but also to continue to drive down the unit cost of building new stations, which we've done very successfully over recent years. And then that makes it an easier decision for the people who control budgets in order to, you know, build new stations. And it's great that because Scotland's railway is perceived to be such a success story, more and more communities across the country want to be connected to the rail network. And it's fantastic being at the opening of East Linton station December last year and listening to the people who've lived there for years. They've now got a train station and it's changing their lives for the better.
Thank you. And a couple of questions from the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you. These questions are probably primarily for Alex Hines and Joanne Maguire.
I'm an MSP for the capital here, Edinburgh, and they relate to casework that I've received on two important issues that relate to the whole country. Firstly, it's well known that the line from Edinburgh to Inverness is often busy, sometimes overcrowded, given the tourist attractions that there are on that line and its importance to the tourism economy as well as local travel. So I wondered if you had any comment on that in terms of increasing the capacity in the short, medium or longer term. And secondly, we have two remarkable cities in the Central Belt as well as a number of other important areas, but two worldwide cities that have great nighttime economies and cultural offerings and sporting events. This summer, last summer in 2023, the festivals came to an agreement with yourselves and the government to have travel later on in the trains. And from all accounts, that was very successful. What thought is going into providing later trains between Waverley and Queen Street on a more regular basis, say on a Thursday, Friday and Saturday night? Because you talked about the market and demand earlier and how it's increasing around weekends, but the exploration as to what demand could be created with later services in the nighttime economy hasn't really been properly explored in the way it has been in other places.
Right, OK. Thank you for those questions. So firstly, on the Edinburgh to Inverness line, I live on that line, so I'm familiar with the issues on that route very intimately. And critical to our performance on that part of the rail network is the delivery of our high-speed trains, because our high-speed trains have four or five carriages and customers enjoy the experience that they have on those trains. And sometimes we send a shorter train than planned, and that's something we need to stop doing. And the way we are going to resolve that issue is by delivering our recruitment drive on depots. So those trains are primarily maintained at either Haymarket here in Edinburgh or at Inverness. And we are in the process of filling every single vacancy at those two depots, and indeed other depots across the country. And when I was at Haymarket last week, it was great to meet some of the new joiners. And as I said to Douglas Lumsden, MSP, since the start of the year, we've started to see the benefit of that in terms of better consistency of delivery on that route. By September of this year, we will have filled every vacancy and all of those staff will be fully competent in the tasks which they have to undertake on the depot. So I am expecting month by month improvement between now and September as we give our teams on depots the tools to do the job to maintain them and keep them available for customers. In terms of festivals and later night services, obviously we operate later night services during the festival anyway. We have been experimenting in previous Christmases with later night services, and one of the issues we always face is if we run an additional service, is it going to cover its costs or not? Now, clearly, we've had been through a pandemic. Our passenger journeys are still 15% down. But if we carry on growing fast as we are and customers continue to come back to the network, that enables us to make better business cases. So we can go to Scottish Rail Holdings and go to Transport Scotland and say, we'd like to add these services in, and commercially they wash their face. Whereas at the moment, what tends to happen is when we look at business cases for additional services, sometimes they don't always cover their costs, and then it becomes a bit of a difficult equation around, is that something we want to do but put the subsidy requirement up, which obviously is already relatively high, at over £700 million a year. So it's something we're acutely aware of. It's something we're keen to do more of in the future. And as the railway comes back post-COVID, it's something we can look more at. But we have to remember there are still 15% fewer customers on our railway than there were 5 years ago. And that makes the economics of making these services commercially wash their face more challenging.
We'd use it if it was there. later into the night. But it's how do you survey that and quantify that? Limited trial periods, that's some insight, but I think it would require a longer trial period to see the commercial benefits. Which,
okay.
Sorry, Joanne McGuire, did you want to add anything?
Just to confirm that from the on your Inverness to Edinburgh concerns, every time we change the timetable, we plan the length of the trains against that, and we are planning enhancements where we'll be sending further 5 car services as opposed to 3 at key times of the day, including weekends, when previously we've only looked at that on a Monday to Friday basis, and that all links back to the improved maintenance resource we've got in the depots. So we are planning to make improvements, and we're conscious of the number of passengers we will carry over the summer as we see tourist season ramping up and the important impact that has on the economies of those cities.
Thank you both. That was very interesting.
And just clarify that the nighttime economy in Inverness stops at 9:32, which is the last time you can get on a train from Inverness to head back towards Aberdeen. So there's no late night services on that line. 2 quick questions, if I may. We've got Caledonian Sleepers and we've got ScotRail, 2 different organisations, part of the same organisation now. Are we going to see a merging of boards and management structures so it all comes under one? Because it all belongs to one group of people, the people of Scotland. Jan, Catherine, who wants to answer?
Happy to go first. So that will be, over time, I'm sure, a matter for Scottish Rail Holdings as our owning group to consider. But for current times, there are no plans because we, in fact, run 2 very distinct businesses, and the decision was taken some years ago to maintain those as 2 very distinct businesses. So at this present time, there are no plans to merge our very much daytime service with what is a very much distinct customer offering through the night.
For keeping those apart, wouldn't they, within the management structure?
So what we have said is potentially separate to management structure, there could be opportunities within what we would call our back office and support structures that we might be able to explore in future in terms of how we could work together.
Might in the future. Is that being looked at the moment?
As Catherine said, it's very early days for sleeper and public ownership, and she might want to add more, but I think 6 months in, it's not been top of the priority list in delivering the transfer.
No, I mean, to ensure I don't repeat what Joanne said, our back office services are being delivered by Circa under a 12-month agreement, so we're concentrating on successfully extracting ourselves from Serco and being a standalone business. So that's our focus at the moment. That's quite a high risk project, and we need to make sure that goes well. Once that's done and it's settled, phase 2 would be to look at if there are any back office synergies. My personal view is there would be, and I think we're all committed to looking at that.
Okay, and final question, I guess, is I'm not sure who's going to answer it, but I remember when, Alex, you first came into this committee that we had the PPMs was the excitement figure, and it was used to beat Abellio up about why they weren't performing to the requirement that the government has set. Well, ScotRail ain't meeting those targets either, and they've got less trains on the track. So my question is, is there a marked improvement, and were PPMs unnecessary, unrequired, or unhelpful? And is everything fine now, despite the fact that you're not reaching the targets that Abellio reached in the past?
Well, actually, it's not a target for ScotRail. It's a target for Scotland's Railway. So Transport Scotland, Scottish Rail Holdings, set 92.5 ppm, as we measure it, public performance measure, for both ScotRail and for Network Rail. And as of this morning, we were hovering about 90% of ppm. I'm pleased to say that since the last time we were at committee, performance continues to improve. And together we're working really hard to improve performance on the network, particularly in the area of ScotRail fleet and Network Rail weather management, to work together to reach that target as fast as we can. It's a challenging target to meet because it measures lots of things that we don't control, like trespass and vandalism and weather, for example. But our good performance, the most punctual large operator in Britain, is underpinning the service that we're providing to our customers. And so it's pleasing to see that, you know, 9 out of 10 customers are satisfied with the service that they pay for.
And I guess that answer took me back to the answer to the first question on that subject, which I seem to remember was probably lodged by Stuart Stevenson at the committee. But interesting, nothing's changed then. Thank you very much. That concludes our session. I'm briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave, but I'd ask committee members to be back here by 12:30 at the very latest, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next item is consideration of a negative instrument, the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Amendment Order 2024. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul the instrument. No motion to annul the instrument has been lodged. As the clerk's paper notes, the instrument is laid in all four UK legislators and is UK-wide. Do any members have any comments on the instrument? Mark.
Thanks. I was just going to make a brief comment that I think it's important that the UK emissions trading scheme continues to align with the EU emissions trading scheme, because as we've seen with the interaction between the Swiss scheme and the EU scheme, the direction of travel here is probably to link the schemes at some point in the future, and that offers more certainty for business. But from what I can see, what's been brought forward here doesn't change that question around alignment. You know, the number of free allocations is not being altered by the instrument, so I don't really see any significant divergence coming as a result of this. So that satisfies me that we've got our own scheme, EU's got theirs, but the potential to link those together after the reform of the trade and cooperation agreement is still on the table.
Okay, Monica, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I think that's a good summary by Mark Ruskell, and I would agree with that.
Okay. Okay, so therefore, that noted, and thanks, Mark, for doing that. I'd just invite the committee to agree it doesn't want to wish any make any recommendations in relation to the instrument. Are we agreed? We are agreed. That concludes our part of the public meeting, and we're now to go into private session.